Road, at a crash 16th at Harding Street, northeast side crash on the streets, it's Commerce Road west of I-69. Looking at Hancock County, crash westbound at 70, about 2.5 miles after State Road 9. And yeah, that's stopping traffic back to State Road 9. I would use US 40 instead. Traffic sponsored by Staples Stores. Staples Stores provide innovative products and services for small business, remote workers and learners, even teachers and parents. Explore more at your local Staples store. I'm Matt Bear with traffic on the fives. Follow us at WIBC Traffic.
To me, the most important word in the world is dignity. There are certain God-given rights to be fed, to have shelter, medicine, and clothing. When many of our clients come to us, they face the great risk of losing much of what they have. In some cases, losing everything. I'm John Morgan of Morgan & Morgan. In one instant, an accident, a natural disaster, or the intentional acts of others can threaten our dignity. Whether it's the loss of a paycheck, paying medical bills, enduring a life of pain and suffering, or a claim with your own insurance company, or a business dispute, and you can't afford to pay a lawyer by the hour, your dignity hangs in the balance. You only pay us if we recover for you. Let my firm fight for you, your family, and your dignity. Call us for a free consultation. Dial pound law on your cell phone. That's pound 529. Morgan & Morgan, forthepeople.com.
Go where the pros go. Drexel Interiors for Timberlake Kitchen and Bath Cabinets. Visit Drexel's new design center on 146th Street at River Road or on North Shadeland. DrexelIN.com.
The forecast from the American Standard Heating Weather Center.
Our Thursday ahead looks to be partly to mostly cloudy in the forecast. Hopefully we'll see some clouds decrease later in the day. High temperature 47 degrees, winds out of the east at 5 to 10 miles per hour. I'm Wish TV Storm Track 8, meteorologist Rudolph Sudis for 93 WIBC.
31 and cloudy downtown. I'm Kurt Darling on the level, on the go, and on WIBC.com.
You're listening to Rob Kendall.
When we talk about sending money somewhere, we're talking about printing the money because we have no money.
And Casey Daniels.
My government would never lie to me, would they?
On 93 WIPC.
Good morning, Indianapolis. Happy Thursday to you. This is Ethan Hatcher. Today, I'm filling in on the Kendall and Casey show, joined by the fantastic gentleman from Georgia, none other than Brian Baker. Hello, sir. How are you this morning?
Good morning, Ethan Hatcher. Good morning, Indianapolis. And I do believe we have things connected properly this time. I'm quite excited about that. I was fearing that we were going to have the usual technical disaster anytime we try this.
No, not today. We have producer Kev at the helm, and producer Kevin always presses the buttons and makes sure that everything functions flawlessly for a Marconi-worthy broadcast.
Things go well when you hire good people.
Okay.
And
so,
things go poorly when you hire bad people.
Indeed.
It's U.S. federal government.
Well,
let us begin.
Speaking of the U.S. federal government, we had some fiery testimony yesterday at the House Oversight Committee impeachment hearing. They invited Hunter Biden's former business partner, Tony Bobulinski, to give his testimony regarding the Biden crime family's peddling of influence while he was the vice president. And it led to some fascinating moments. And we now have it, at least on the record, eyewitness to these accounts saying that Joe Biden was not just a participant. He was an active enabler.
I want to be crystal clear. From my direct personal experience and what I've subsequently come to learn, it is clear to me that Joe Biden was the brand being sold by the Biden family. His family's foreign influence peddling operation from China to Ukraine and elsewhere sold out to foreign actors who are seeking to gain influence and access to Joe Biden and the United States government. Joe Biden was more than a participant in and a beneficiary of his family's business. He was an active, aware enabler who met with business associates such as myself to further the business, despite being buffered by a complex scheme to maintain plausible deniability. I ask this big question. If there's no evidence of corruption here today, if Joe's conduct and the conduct of his family were fully legal and proper, then why are they so dishonest about it?
Boom. Roasted.
And that was just how that was just how the Oversight Committee hearing began. That was his opening statement, Brian. This was fiery stuff. What were your impressions?
Did they have the orchestra in the room with them as well?
Yes, it was right in the back in the chamber in, you know, the elevated observing section. That's where they were.
You know, it's funny because I listened to the highlights from the hearing, and I must tell you, it is so disturbing to me, Ethan, that these are such incredibly serious charges. But I realized something as I have sort of been away from WIBC for a long time and have not been in the news cycle every single day. And it occurs to me that the majority of individuals out there who have the power to vote have a very surface level understanding of what's actually going on and the crimes that the Biden family is being accused of.
Well, and you'll hear later in the show how even some congresswomen don't seem to understand the nature of crimes that the Biden family has been accused of. But we'll be getting more into that in hour two, so make sure to stay tuned. But yeah, go on, explain.
I was just going to say that I think the challenge that we all face as a country is that there is so much of this and is a constant bombardment that I think a lot of folks have kind of tuned out, and they just assume, okay, well, if the Biden family is being accused, it's just politics. If they're going after Trump, it's just politics. And no one really has the time or the interest, nor I think the integrity to actually take a look at any of this and pay attention to it and really dig into what's happening. So that's why you can get away with just these quick sound bites on biased news broadcasts for people like AOC just grandstanding and putting on a show, and you know their followers just lap it right up.
Well, part of the reason why people have become disengaged is because of the rampant dishonesty, not only from partisan media sources, like you said, but from the politicians themselves who are actively running interference for the Biden crime family, which I was happy to see Tony Bobulinski specifically calling Jamie Raskin a liar to his face during the hearing. Oh, you heard this? This was great, Brian. I loved it.
The same people preaching this mantra know better. They continue to lie directly to the American people without hesitation and remorse. Rep. Dan Goldman and Jamie Raskin, both lawyers, and Mr. Goldman, a former prosecutor with the SDNY from New York, will continue to lie today in this hearing and then go straight to the media to tell more lies. Hunter Biden's defense attorney, Abby Lowell, weaponizes letters to Congress to try to smear my name.
Mr. Chairman.
The cold hard facts.
Mr. Chairman.
In an attempt to save his powerfully connected client and his father, I challenge Mr. Lowell to make those claims on national television so he can be held accountable for his lies.
Now you want to get nuts? Come on. Let's get nuts.
This was great.
Wow.
I loved it, Brian.
Oh, man. A very brave man. He'll be suicided by the end of the week, Ethan.
Yes. with a suicide note written in a different handwriting. So usually how it works. Yeah.
Go ahead. Very brave man. Go ahead, man.
No, I mean, I was just about to say, to see this witness call out the congressman, because usually this is an opportunity for the congressman to grandstand and bully the witness and get their sound bites, but it just wasn't going in Jamie Raskin's favor, which you'll hear more of in hour two, because I also have his response lined up, and it was comical to see the tables turned on the liberal congressman.
It's disheartening to know that the two candidates that we have running for president here are involved and accused of so many different crimes, isn't it, Ethan?
Oh, yes. It's fantastic that this is the best that America could come up with for the election cycle. But it's the reality that we have to deal with. And reality is squarely what we deal with in the vicinity of WIBC.
Indeed.
Now, there was another issue that we had come up, and this was a shocker to me. Of course, on Tuesday, the Supreme Court had allowed Texas to arrest migrants. They said that law was able to be enforced, but they didn't rule on its constitutionality. And they did a weird thing where they kicked it back down to the lower court. And the U.S. Circuit Court of Appeals in the 5th District then overturned it and paused the law from going into action. And if this is confusing to you, it was to a lot of people, and it was explained in Fox 4, the process of how this happened.
Following the developments in this story could give you whiplash. In the space of 36 hours, Senate Bill 4 was blocked from taking effect. Then the stay was lifted for just several hours. Now the controversial law is on hold again. Late last night, the 5th U.S. Circuit Court of Appeals issued an order that prevents SB 4. 2024 from taking effect. The law would give Texas law enforcement officers the authority to arrest anyone they suspect of crossing into the United States illegally. Hours before the order from the Fifth Circuit, the U.S. Supreme Court allowed the strict new immigration law to take effect. The nation's highest court didn't address whether the Texas law is constitutional. The justices then sent the measure back to the appellate court, and they issued the ruling late last night. The Biden administration and immigrant rights groups are suing Texas over the law, saying it violates the Constitution and will lead to racial profiling.
Holy Jesus. What is that? What the f*** is that?
Okay, Brian, there's a couple problems here. To my mind, I'm not sure how it's unconstitutional for states to enforce federal law that's on the books. We have immigration law. You can enforce those laws. And as far as discrimination is concerned, I'm not sure we have lots of Swedish or Canadian immigrants at our southern border in Texas. What are you talking about? This is the fact that immigration has become a political football and it's now risen to the top. It's a primary issue in this election for the first time in ages. That shows you how dire the situation is at our southern border. And it's because of crap like this that I think people's patience is wearing extremely thin, Brian. What say you?
Yeah, but, you know, these people, they just, I'm convinced they absolutely hate the country. Ethan,
sure.
And they just want their political will be done. And if that means a fundamental transformation of the entire country and throwing constitutional law out the window, then they're more than happy to do that as long as it fits neatly into their narrative and allows them to change the country in the manner that they see it. As a greater and more perfect union.
This isn't a conspiracy. This is something, and you can look up the clip for yourself. Congresswoman Clark out of New York specifically talking about how immigrants in her district would, or more immigrants in the districts of New York would give them more representation because that's how the apportionment is figured out. And they count illegal immigrants. So yes, this is about re-engineering the country and putting the thumb on the scale to give added representation in Democrat states. I mean, they elucidated as much themselves.
Well, the silver lining in all of this, Ethan, is that they've virtually guaranteed that Donald Trump is going to win his re-election or his election bid coming up here in November. So, you know, you got to look at the positive side of these things here. But do you realize how easy it would have been for Joe Biden to actually get a win if he'd have just kept some of Trump's policies in place and added to them? He would be a hero, not only amongst, well, I guess he'd be a villain amongst Democrats, but, you know, moderates and Republicans, they might have actually rallied behind him and been supportive, but he's just been a disaster. And, you know, God bless him. He's paving the way for Donald Trump to return to the White House.
Well, now it's too little too late, and we can see the gross partisanship and the disingenuous display that only now, after 3 years of dismantling the immigration policy of the nation, that Joe Biden has suddenly decided, oh, you know, immigration is important after all, as is securing our southern border. Like, we see through you, old man. We see through the lies. Yeah. Thanks for
I love when he has the slip-ups and calls them illegal immigrants and then has to backtrack and apologize lest he get in trouble with the people that are really running the show.
Oh, we'll be getting into that. This is an hour or three of a conversation. You wanted to talk about how presidential elections have changed over the last 30 years, and we have a clip of Bill Clinton practically sounding like Donald Trump at a 1995 State of the Union. And then, yes, the media collectively losing their mind because Joe Biden accurately referred to the murderer of Laken Riley as an illegal immigrant, which he is. This is mind-numbing, but it is the reality we live in. Thanks for listening to 93 WIBC. This is the Kendall and Casey Show. Ethan Hatcher, Brian Baker filling in. Up next, friends of the program, Matt Bear and Ryan Hedrick are going to join and talk about their fantastic podcast dealing with helping sobriety, and we'll be talking more about that in the next segment, so stay tuned.
Tony Katz.
I also did say that men are not women and women are not men, and men do not breastfeed and never will, because those are facts. And anybody who says otherwise, that person shouldn't be allowed to practice medicine. They're crazy. I will have that debate with anyone at any med school anywhere. Let's start setting a standard that we focus on medicine and not insanity.
Tony Katz, mornings 6 to 9 on 93 WIPC and WIPC.com. Spring is here and you want to be enjoying your life, enjoying the outdoors. It is impossible to do if you're in constant pain. Pain in your hips, your back, your shoulder, those joints, whether it's arthritis pain, sports injury, an injury on the job. Talk to QC Kinetics and you don't have to live with the pain. QC Kinetics here in Indy, and it's the nation's leader in regenerative medicine. We're talking about lasting joint pain relief with no surgery, no drugs, and no downtime. Pro athletes have been doing this for decades, but now this life-changing treatment is available for you. Walk, run, climb the stairs, play golf, move again with no pain, no risky surgery. It's an all-natural solution. QC Kinetics is in Eagle Creek, in Greenwood, and in Carmel. Call today, 317-559-PAIN. 317-559-PAIN. Talk to QC Kinetics. They even have Saturday appointments available. QC Kinetics. Find the location closest to you. Eagle Creek, Greenwood, and Carmel. 317-559-PAIN.
Planning on inviting friends and family over for a basketball tournament, hockey finals, or baseball preseason? Whatever you're hosting this spring, you know the hustle to get the house looking perfect. But there's one thing you can't fix on your own. It's the issues with your home's foundation. If you have an uneven front porch, you find yourself tripping over the raised parts of the driveway, or you've noticed a cracked pool deck, those things will surely stand out and ruin your fun. Keep your gatherings fun and your home safe, and make sure your place is the place everyone wants to come to watch the game. Indiana Foundation Service knows how to fix these types of problems for you in no time. Schedule a free visit and Indiana Foundation Service's team of experts will stop by to help you out. Head over to IndianaFoundation.com today to book your appointment. That's IndianaFoundation.com. Indiana Foundation Service. There's a reason they are the trusted local experts.
Indiana Foundation Service. Reliability from the ground up.
Why is the $29 tune-up special from Broad Ripple Service Experts such a big deal? You save $100 and they could save your AC. Broad Ripple Service Experts can help restore your AC's reliability and extend its life, saving you up to 30% on energy bills and keeping your equipment warranty valid. And their service is 100% guaranteed. Broad Ripple Service Experts is all about making you feel right at home. Get total home comfort with their $29 tune-up. Call 866-EXPERTS today. License numbers HL110000.
Are you over 30 and putting off life insurance? It's time to get a quick quote from Ethos, a better, easier way to get term life insurance, all online with no medical exam. Answer a few health questions and you could be approved for up to $2 million. Isn't it worth 10 minutes to help protect your family's financial security? Ethos, up to $2 million in coverage with no medical exam. Some policies as low as a dollar a day. Answer a few health questions and get your free quote at checkethos.com. That's checkethos.com.
24/7 ER care for kids. 24/7 peace of mind for you. Riley Children's Health emergency doctors and nurses are in the ER around the clock at IU Health North in Carmel. Learn more at rileychildrens.org/ER.
Indy's leader in patio installation is now offering a new driveway package. Schedule a free estimate today at IndyDecorativeConcrete.com. That's IndyDecorativeConcrete.com.
Welcome back to the Kendall and Casey Show. I'm Ethan Hatcher, joined by Brian Baker. And in studio with us is the dynamic duo, Matt Bear, Ryan Hedrick, helming the podcast, supporting sobriety. Now, I'd only gotten to listen to this a little bit last night in preparation for the segment, and I really want to compliment you guys. You do a fantastic job. You just aired your 10th episode, and this is really heady stuff, really important stuff, and I'm glad that you guys are willing and able to talk so frankly about very distressing times in your life.
Oh, thanks, man. Thanks for saying so. Yeah, we're having a lot of fun putting this together, and yeah, we're telling some stories that make us feel really uncomfortable. But that's part of the thing. You know, maybe through our honesty, we can help somebody out. It's a podcast that's dedicated to, and yeah, we tell our I guess, war stories, you know, our drunken stories and our stone stories. But at the same time, the podcast is designed for what we call the people behind the people. It's for the people that put up with us, that we traumatize, that we put through all this hell. It's our caregivers, you know, our mothers, fathers, significant others. That's who we're trying to help out. Kind of a living amends, maybe, Ryan? Is that what we're doing?
I never would have imagined when I started doing this, the reaction that we would get from judges, from people in the field, from different recovering addicts and alcoholics reaching out to us saying, hey, thank you for being so vulnerable in order to get your point across. I mean, there's a level of vulnerability that you have to share in recovery meetings anyway. And Matt and I joke all the time, it's about a fourth step, which is a searching and fearless moral inventory in a 12-step program. And that's what we do every podcast. But in order for this to be completely effective and to reach people the way we want it to resonate with people, we have to be open to every degree in our recovery process.
Well, what I really appreciate is, again, you know, how honest you are and how, yes, when addiction has its grasp deeply a hold of you and it's, you know, fingers tight in your body, you're going to do a lot of embarrassing things that you reflect on in retrospect. But instead of just having the damage that was dealt from those choices, you've now marshaled that into a net positive, into a net benefit, because you're sharing those stories with other people and giving them room to reflect and improve potentially on their own lives.
Well, we want to let everybody know that they're not in it alone. Yeah. I mean, that's the problem with addiction. I mean, you put yourself, your only friend is your drug of choice. For me, that was alcohol. Now, I did just about everything, but alcohol was always with me since I was 14 years old. And I always felt like I was by myself in it. Now, and I come from a culture of drinking, you know, and they're totally cool. I love my family to death. They can drink and shut it down. I don't have that ability. When I start drinking, I'm drinking to get drunk and as fast as I can. It's always been like that when I've been drinking. And when you get there and you just keep the disease, it's a progressive disease. The disease of addiction keeps going and going and working on you and grinding you down. All you feel like is you're by yourself with this alcohol. It has complete control of you. And it's giving this message to, hey, yeah, you may not be able to reach this person right now. You may not be able to reach your son or your daughter or your husband or your wife, whatever it might be. But there is still a living human being inside that person, and they are good. What you're seeing right now is not that person. So it's a message. You know, you are not doing this thing alone.
Yeah, and I think the position that we take in every podcast is that addiction is a disease because it falls under the category of progressive, incurable, and fatal, much like cancer. And I think the world has started to treat addiction like a disease, giving people like myself and Matt tons of hope when, man, 10 years ago when I was doing meth and coke and drinking and destroying my life a day at a time, there was no hope for me. So I'm grateful that we could pass it on to people just like us.
Well,
you know, I think it's really educational for people as well, guys, that here you have something that, if you haven't been exposed to it directly, if you haven't struggled with alcoholism and addiction, or you haven't known somebody or loved somebody who has struggled with that, very often there's this judgment from the outside of, well, this seems like, okay, yeah, this is a disease that, well, that's an easy thing to cure. Just don't drink. And a lot of people don't really understand that there comes a point where it's, you're not wanting to get drunk. You're not wanting to escape. You're trying to get back to a baseline level because your nervous system is just going haywire and you've become addicted to the substance.
I'm so glad you brought that up, Brian, because I used to be one of those people. I really was. I remember somebody telling me a story about their alcoholic father, and I'm like, well, why does he just put it down? I was in my early 20s, and I didn't get it, obviously. What you said is so true. Once you were in it, especially as an alcoholic, I identify as an alcoholic, but at the same time, you know, alcoholics and addicts are the same to me. But as an alcoholic, as deep as I was into the vodka, if I didn't have it, my hands would shake uncontrollably. If I didn't have it, I would go into the DTs at work, nonetheless, while I was doing my reporting. And you hallucinate. You really do. You see colors. You move your head. And if you don't have that alcohol, you don't get back to that baseline like you were talking about, Brian. It is such a vicious cycle because you are drinking to stay alive, essentially. Because cardiac arrest through alcohol withdrawals can kill you, kill you quickly. And it's one of those things where your heart, your body just starts to quit on you, just starts to die on you while you're just trying to live everyday life.
Because at that point, it's crossed over into a chemical dependency, and that's when the damage really, you know, aggravates and exacerbates its effects on your body regressively.
Yeah, for sure.
This is 93 WIBC, Kendall and Casey Show. We've been having a conversation with Matt Bear and Ryan Hedrick about their fantastic podcast, Supporting Sobriety. We'll be continuing the conversation in the next segment, but first, I got to cut to Kurt Darling in the news up next.
Everyone wants energy that's reliable and affordable. I've been a Duke Energy line worker here in Indiana for almost 20 years, so I'm proud to help deliver that for the people and the communities that matter most to me. With stronger, more resilient systems, better able to stand up to severe weather, and support for local businesses and jobs. It feels good knowing I'm helping build a smarter energy future for all of us.
Paid for by Duke Energy shareholders.
93 WIBC Mobile News, on the level, on the go.
Forgiven. Radar is clear. It's cloudy and 31 downtown. I'm Kurt Darling. Here's what's trending at 9:30. President Biden canceling nearly $6 billion worth of student loan debt for about 78,000 public service workers. A new announcement from the White House says that workers, including teachers, nurses, and firefighters, will be getting the debt relief through the Public Service Loan Forgiveness Program. Americans are living longer. Fox's Tanya J. Powers.
The CDC's National Center for Health Statistics crunched the numbers and found that life expectancy in the U.S. increased in 2022 after 2 years of decline. The federal mortality data report showed that life expectancy at birth was 77 and a half years old in 2022. That's up a little more than a year from 2021, but not back to pre-pandemic levels. Heart disease and cancer remained the two leading causes of death. Tanya J. Powers, Fox News.
Now nearly $2 billion up for grabs in America's two biggest lotteries. Nobody won the grand prize in last night's Powerball drawing, so the jackpot jumps up to an estimated $750 million for Saturday's drawing. The Mega Millions jackpot at their next drawing, an estimated $977 million. Your opening bell report on 93 WIBC, brought to you by Absolute Wealth Management, LLC. Another good start to the day. The Dow is up 126 to 40,066. The NASDAQ is up 177 to 18,657. And the S&P 500 is up 25 to 5,312. I'm Kurt Darling, on the level, on the go, and on WIBC.com.
I have diabetes. I'm at risk for pneumococcal pneumonia.
I have asthma. I'm at risk, too.
If you're 19 or older with chronic conditions like asthma, diabetes, COPD, or heart disease, or are 65 or older, you are at increased risk for pneumococcal pneumonia. Ask your doctor or pharmacist about Prevnar 20, pneumococcal 20-valent conjugate vaccine, a Pfizer vaccine that can help protect you against pneumococcal pneumonia in just one dose. Even if you've already been vaccinated with other pneumonia vaccines, Prevnar 20 may help provide added protection. Prevnar 20 is approved for adults to help prevent infections from 20 strains of the bacteria that cause pneumococcal pneumonia. Continued approval may depend on a supportive study. Don't get Prevnar 20 if you've had a severe allergic reaction to the vaccine or its ingredients. Adults with weakened immune systems may have a lower response to the vaccine. Side effects include pain and swelling at the injection site, fatigue, headache, muscle, and joint pain. For full prescribing information, please call 1-855-213-2138 or visit Prevnar20.com.
Indy's biggest party is back. Miller Lite Carb Day, Friday, May 24, featuring George Thorogood and the Destroyers. With special guest, Gin Blossoms. Miller Lite Carb Day, May 24th at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. Concert, pit, and VIP tickets on sale now at IMS.com.
You're listening to the Kendall and Casey Show on 93 WIPC.
I pulled in the 93 WIBC. This is the Kendall and Casey Show. Ethan Hatcher from Saturday Night on the Circle and the stuntman extraordinaire of the silver screen, Brian Baker, joining the program with Matt Bear and Ryan Hedrick. And we've been discussing their podcast, Supporting Sobriety, that they've recently launched and now having aired their 10th episode, checking in on some of the stories that you've shared. And Ryan, there was a word that you used in the last segment I really want to hone in on, and I heard it when I was listening to the podcast as well, disease. When you're talking about addiction like a disease, some critics may say, well, it's not a disease because you don't go buy a dime baggie of cancer to snort. You don't inject yourself with leukemia like, oh, I just got to have another drink of leukemia and go to the leukemia store and, you know, buy that. So, you know, what would you say to the critics who say that addiction is not a disease? It's a very serious problem, but a different one.
So the operative word in that question to me was critics, because I don't think you're in a position, and there may be some treatment experts listening and I may alienate them with what I'm about to say, but I've never met a doctor or a psychologist or a treatment expert that actually knew what addiction was and how it functioned in the brain of an addict. I mean, I can remember, and I'm drawing on my own experiences, using against my will, wanting to stop, but using against my will. So I would make the argument respectfully so to any critics that would say it's not a disease. Look at people that are leaving their kids at home while they go cop drugs. Look at anybody that's using drugs in a car with their children in the back seat. Look at anybody, any self-respecting professional like myself, like Matt Bear, who's ruined their careers over getting one more drink or drug and then tell me it's not a disease. It's incurable, it's progressive, and it's fatal, just like any of the things that you mentioned. So, you know, there's a lot of talk about it because there's a lot of money going into these things, but a lot of the experts are saying from a standpoint of like, well, we think the addict or the alcoholic can stop, but there's all evidence to the contrary. So that's what I would say to an expert that would tell me it's not a disease.
If he knows someone, I'm sorry, go ahead, Matt.
Oh, it's an excellent point, Ryan, and that's the thing. When I would relapse, I did several times before I got sober like I am now, you know, going on 3 years. Ryan, you're coming up to 3 years, too. Right?
I am. All right. Yep. Yeah, May 15th.
Congratulations to you. Thanks, both, man. By the way.
Appreciate yeah, thank it. You. Thank you, sir. It's when I was relapsing, it was never, boy, I'm having fun right now.
Yeah.
I love sitting on my couch doing nothing. I love there being no women around. I mean, it was never like that. It was like, I cannot believe I'm here again. I cannot believe I'm doing this to myself, to my family, to my coworkers, to you. What would have been you? I can't believe I'm here right now, yeah. Again, drunk, and exactly where Brian Baker said in the last segment, I've got to have it or I am going to die or I have to go to treatment, which means I have to go look my boss, David Wood, in the eye and say, hey, I'm drunk again. I got to go back to rehab. You don't want to be there. When this thing grabs you, it does not let go, and that goes for alcohol. That goes for methamphetamine. That goes for fentanyl and all the hardcore, you know, fentanyl is the opiate of all opiates, and they even have bigger ones out than that. When you get into that stuff, you cannot come out. So why? Why else would there be there? If I could put it down, I would.
It's a fantastic answer. Mm. Brian, did you have something to say?
The other thing that really has struck me in binging this podcast, guys, is, Matt, you and I have known each other for several years now, and up until you guys decided to go forward with this podcast, I had no idea that this had been a struggle in your life. And I wasn't necessarily surprised, because you're a highly empathetic person, very creative, and sometimes that comes with a balance that people that are highly empathetic experience life in different ways than folks who maybe don't have so much of that trait in their personality. But it just really stood out to me that, my gosh, here's someone that I've known for quite some time, and I had no idea that they were suffering. And I think, how many addicts out there are suffering in silence, going about their day and you know, they're acting like, hey, this is, everything's fine, and they're just absolutely rotting inside.
A lot. I sponsor a lot of men in this city and other cities who are suffering in silence because they feel the stigma is too great to deal with. They feel embarrassed by something that they can't control. You know, the biggest thing that addicts and alcoholics get hemmed up on is control. Control is an illusion, And in the first step in the 12-step process, we learn that control isn't possible the moment it's suggested. And I tell men that I sponsor, if you think you can control your drug using, you have to continue. You're almost forced to continue because in your mind, you've made the decision that I'm going to control this come hell or high water and nothing is going to stop me. It hasn't worked for millions of people. It will never work for people that are using. They can't control. Once that first drug gets in you, it alters your mind, it alters your spirit, and you're off to the races.
My first time, I went to a rehabilitation. It was at Fairbanks here in Indianapolis, a community north up on the northeast side. I don't know why I just gave him an ad there. But it was a thing where I went up and I got into it. And again, I had the whole thing, the hands shaking, the DTs, and you know, all the withdrawal symptoms. And I'm sitting in the Fairbanks parking lot eating like three triple steak burgers from Steak and Shake, just having at it. And I'm going in, I'm going to get myself sober, and my blood pressure's through the moon. And I wasn't in there for more than 24 hours. And I said, I can moderate this. I can control my drinking. And I wasn't out of Fairbanks. I checked myself out after 11 days. I'm back on the road. And I stop at the liquor store, and instead of vodka, I buy wine. Because that's not as bad as vodka, you know, in my mind, in the alcoholic mind. Well, you know, I'm back to two bottles, two and a half bottles, three bottles a night, and then you're right back to the vodka. I cannot moderate. Now, maybe somebody can, but I don't know anybody in a 12-step recovery program of the alcoholic variety that says, yeah, I not only kicked it, but I can have a glass of wine every now and then. It just doesn't work like that for us. It doesn't.
93 WIBC, Kendall and Casey Show. We've been talking with Matt Baer and Ryan Hedrick about their podcast, Supporting Sobriety. One question I wanted to ask you guys before we wrap up the segment here. For those who are in the depths of addiction, for those who are, you know, where you were 3-4 years ago, in the darkest of places, where can they find the motivation to make a change? And perhaps where did you, when you were in that pit of despair, what was the light at the end of the tunnel that made you say, now's got to be a time of choosing and a time of change?
It's not an aha moment. Matt, we just pushed out a really good episode on tough love.
And
I think it takes a, I don't want to be Hillary Clinton-ish, but it takes a...
Nobody wants to be Hillary Clinton.
It takes a village because there are certain people that helped me get to a point. It was a combination of jails, institutions, tough love from my parents, rejection from lovers and bosses and friends. I mean, I've been in the radio business for 10 to 15 years. I've been fired from every station I've been at in the past 5 years before the past couple of stations, before I got my life back on track, because I didn't want to stop using. Nothing motivated me, not one incentive, not one bit of money, not one consequence motivated me. Everybody has a special trapdoor bottom. But those bottoms have trap doors that you can fall through. So honestly, it's a combination of God, the realization that I can't control my using for any length of time, and a break, some type of break in your spirit that says, I can't use successfully. And that looks different for everybody else.
Yeah, and the G word there, God. For me, it was accepting spiritual concepts. I wasn't an atheist. I was a person who rejected spirituality as a whole. And that isn't not even saying that there is no God. And one day I remember, and I did relapse after this, but this is when I really found my spiritual side and I started to find God. I remember the Indiana's blue laws just came out, the new ones that said you can buy alcohol on Sundays, but you cut off at 6 p.m. So I really wanted to drink that Sunday night. I was trying to make it through. This would be day one after a relapse. I wanted to get through so bad. Couldn't do it. My hands were shaking. I was a mess. I get into my car. I know. Okay. I've got a bad history of that, and I am ashamed of it. But, you know, I tell these stories to help other people out. And I get in my car to drive, and I'm sore. My hands are shaking. I can barely do it. And I'm like, just get to the interstate. If you get on the interstate, And you make it past 6 o'clock, you will not buy that liquor. So I'm driving through Broad Ripple. Don't stop. Keep going. And I'm just saying, God, save me. God, save me over and over again. God, save me. Finally, I make it up to Keystone Avenue, and I'm on westbound 465. It's 545, and I'm like, you made it. just keep driving. And I just kept looping around. It was just that God saved me over and over again that I was able to not drink that day. So I still pray every day, and I pray for humility. I pray for Ryan. I pray for this radio station. I pray for our listeners. And it's just finding that spiritual element. It makes me feel like even on the worst days that I'm not doing it alone.
Yeah, without a spiritual connection, you're lost. But there's hope for everybody. In fact, we end every podcast where there's breath, there's hope. And I really believe that addiction is not a hopeless dilemma. It's not. We bear witness. We are witnesses to where there's breath, there's hope. But, you know, if you see somebody struggling with addiction, please don't just let them fall. Pick them up and believe in them like somebody believed in us.
We're talking about spirituality in this next episode, too. We're finishing up Saturday.
Yeah,
Saturday. We're going to finish it up Saturday. Yep. It'll be out Wednesday. And, you know, it's a huge topic, spirituality and recovery. Yeah. But it's going to be, we're going to scratch the surface on it a little bit. And if people want to check it out, it's all the major podcast providers. We have the Apple link at sobriety_pod. You can check it out there. And again, it's at sobriety_pod, and we're starting a community there, and we're just sitting here right now. I couldn't feel more blessed.
We're grateful.
Well, yes. I know I said I wanted to wrap things up, but I maybe want to squeeze in just one more question, because we've hit on that topic of spirituality, and I think it's an interesting question, because I am an atheist, so I have that lack of belief in divinity, and my question to you would be, do atheists have a hope of kicking their addictions? Can they do it without having a God to anchor that, you know, belief in their journey out of addiction?
Absolutely. And the reason I believe this is because I know alcoholic atheists who are in recovery right now have 20, 25 years and just gobs and gobs of sobriety time. I want to protect the anonymity.
Sure.
Of certain programs. I don't want to give it away, but I want to protect the anonymity. But there are programs out there that kind of go by 12 steps that teach you how to do this. And these programs are perfect. People are not, but the programs are perfect if you just follow the steps.
Yeah, and if you are an atheist, I would say a God of your own understanding is what I would say to latch on to. You could believe in a, when I first got clean, it was a doorknob or somebody else's higher power or the ceiling fan that looked appealing to me. I just held on until I believed in something that I believe in. And the good thing about an anonymous program is I don't have to reveal my God to you. It will become apparent to me through staying clean a day at a time, but it evolves like everything else. Spirituality evolves. Your understanding of God evolves, or who you choose to call God. So, but without a higher power, it's very, very difficult to recover from the disease that we suffer with.
Terrific point.
Thank you guys so much for coming to the studio and sharing your thoughts. Brian, before we close, did you have anything you wanted to add?
I just want to say God bless you guys. I mean, it really does. It takes a special kind of character and a special kind of heart to be that vulnerable and to put yourselves out there in the public sphere like this. And I know it's helping a lot of people. And I can't thank you enough. I mean, it's really a gift that you're giving people with this program.
Thanks, man.
Thanks. I appreciate it. I'm so humbled. Thank you very much for having us.
Thank you for coming on. Yep. This has been Ethan Hatcher and Brian Baker filling in on Kendall and Casey. Stay tuned for more and make sure to support the Supporting Sobriety podcast.
Coming up on Tony Katz Today, I wasn't actually going to do a story about Israel, but wait till you hear Representative Al Green. Holy cow. That's after the news at noon on 93 WIBC.
Have you saved enough? Do you have a plan for Social Security and taxes in retirement? Hey, Casey Weed of Howard Bailey Financial, where our mission is to help you gain clarity and purpose and elevate meaning in your life through personal and practical financial strategies. Financial peace of mind means knowing you've covered all of your bases. And for retirement, that begins with building a solid foundation. That's why we want to give you our Retire with Purpose Toolkit at no cost. In it, you'll find valuable information on minimizing taxes, maximizing Social Security, and building a retirement income you can't outlive. Plus, you'll receive a copy of my book, Job Optional. To get your complimentary toolkit, call or text the keyword INFO 42 to 866-482-9559. That's info 42 to 866-482-9559.
Investment advisory services may be offered through Howard Bailey Securities, LLC, a registered investment advisor. Working with Howard Bailey Securities, LLC cannot guarantee investment success or that specific financial goals will be achieved.
Have you ever felt like you're not good enough? Like you're always falling short? The Bible tells us that we are all sinners and that our sin separates us from God. But God loves us so much that he sent his son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for our sins. Jesus took our place. He became the great exchange. He took our sin upon himself and he gave us his righteousness. Hi, this is Pastor Micah Beckwith. This Easter, March 31st at Life Church, we want to invite you to celebrate the great exchange with us. Go to lifechurchin.com to learn more about our Easter service times.
The deals and specials are sizzling hot. It's the Central Indiana Gun and Knife Show this Saturday and Sunday at the Stoutfield National Guard Armory on West Minnesota Street. The best dealers in the region, hundreds of tables, just $6 for adults, kids 12 and under free. Must be 18 or accompanied by an adult. Buy, sell, trade this Saturday, 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. and Sunday, 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. at the Stoutfield National Guard Armory. For more info, visit centralindianagunshows.com.
At Uline, they know going the extra mile takes hard work. For companies pushing to go further, Uline will go the distance with you. 24/7, they answer the phone to get you the shipping and industrial supplies you need. Business can move fast. Unexpected large orders, adverse weather, new safety guidelines, and changing economic trends. Uline works hard keeping 41,000 items ready to ship, minimizing detours on your way to the extra mile. Visit Uline.com.
Wow, that was an amazing segment. Having Matt Baer and Ryan Hedrick in the studio. And if you missed a moment of that conversation, make sure to peep the podcasts at WIBC.com, where you can find the Kendall and Casey show, as well as my program, hint, hint, Saturday night on The Circle. You can tune in 7 to 9 there as well. I'm joined, of course, by Brian Baker, the gentleman from Georgia, and producer Kev, beep, 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 pushing the buttons and doing everything to make the show function. Brian, you told me about something called brain spotting that I don't understand. I looked it up. It seems like some kind of therapeutic quack science, but I'm not sure if I have an accurate grasp. And you said that this led to your therapist breaking up with you. What happened?
Yes. Well, what is your understanding of brain spotting, Ethan, since you're an intelligent man and you looked into this and have come to the conclusion that it doesn't work?
Well, I don't know, but it said it was a powerful focus treatment method that works by identifying, processing, and releasing core neurophysical sources of emotional body pain, trauma, disassociation, and a variety of other challenging symptoms. Brain spotting is a simultaneous form of diagnosis and treatment enhanced with a bilateral sound, which is deep, direct, and powerful, yet focused and containing. I saw demonstrations of therapists waving a wand around and asking their patients to follow it with their eyes. Is this the process that you were engaging with?
Well, I think perhaps referring to it as a wand might not be helping with the credibility of this kind of treatment. But no, there's a pointer. You're listening to bilateral music, and you go in, and if there's something that you're needing to work on, something that you're having trouble getting past, whether it be emotional or whether it be anything you could possibly come up with that might be a physical ailment that you're challenged by, you are relaxed, you're listening to this bilateral music, and then you are following this pointer, and it moves, the therapist moves it through your field of vision, and you kind of just stay with the emotion and focus on it. And when you reach the point in your field of vision where the emotion becomes very, very intense, or the focus of what you are there to work on becomes just overwhelmingly intense, and you stay focused on that and you process it, the processing is similar to sitting down and just having a traditional cognitive-based therapy where you are talking things out. And where it is fascinating is that it does get to the root of many of the things that might be causing these struggles that you're having. Where my argument is with my therapist on this is that it's supposed to work. It's supposed to work very quickly, and it was sold to me or pitched to me as, you know, this is something that after a couple of sessions you will be past this. And I got all of the data.
That sounds
hokey
in and of itself, though.
Yes, but you know what? I've seen it work. The first time that I tried this years ago, it was very effective for me. But then there was like this point of diminishing returns. And, you know, me being me, I just came to the conclusion. It's like, okay, well, I'm so broken and so screwed up that this isn't going to work on me. And I've seen it do amazing things for people. So, you know, maybe it's like hypnotism. Yeah, that works really well for some people if they're trying to give up cigarettes, or I did hypnotism one time to cut back on Diet Coke. There's another kind of therapy that didn't work for me. I'm drinking it by the gallon every day. I've got one by my side. But ultimately, it led to a little bit of an argument with my therapist, who I've known for quite some time and probably knew a little bit too well. And so she told me she felt like it was time for me to find another therapist to go and get treatment. So I got fired.
Yeah, that seems incredibly uncomfortable. I'm not sure how I would process my therapist breaking up with me, like whether that's a sign of their honesty or a sign of larger problems. I'm not sure how I would take that. You know what I mean, Brian?
So, you know, as I've reflected on it, what I've come to really understand and respect about therapists and folks that work in this profession is that many people that work in this profession are highly empathetic and they care about people and they want to help people. But there also comes a point where you have to draw that line and have certain boundaries.
Yeah.
And I think my therapist, my former therapist, was very, very good at that. And when it came down to a point of, listen, this is going on, I'm struggling with this, but I can't pay $500 a session and go through, you know,
what?
10 sessions of this, you know, and
there was just sort of this, $500 a session?
Yeah, you know, I think it was just the cold response that I got back and the fact that I felt like, okay, well, I'd been led down this path where this was supposed to lead to healing, you know, and so I kind of felt like I got abandoned halfway through, you know?
Yeah, well, I consider yourself fortunate at $500 a session. My God, they're going to bankrupt you. But it sounds like life has really given you a lot of lemons recently, Brian. And you know what they say?
When life gives you lemons, don't make lemonade. Make life take the lemons back. Get mad. I don't want your damn lemons. What am I supposed to do with these? Demand to see life's manager.
So how are you going to be moving on from that, Brian?
You know what? I'm so tired of being mad. I really am. You keep moving forward. You keep with exploration, and you know, you try and grow a little bit every single day, and you start getting into the yellow pages and finding another therapist.
Well, yeah, I don't blame you there. I mean, I also talk with a therapist. He doesn't cost $500 a session, though. You know, but yeah, it's nice just to have somebody to release to, and then, you know, be able to talk to without judgment. I think that's a very valuable service.
Absolutely.
Thanks for listening to 93 WIBC. This is the Kendall and Casey Show. Ethan Hatcher and Brian Baker filling in. Stay tuned for hour two because we're going to be returning with more of the conversation of the fiery testimony offered by Tony Bobulinski at the House Oversight hearing regarding impeachment. More fiery stuff coming up, including AOC not understanding basic federal law, which is absolutely brilliant. I love it. Stay tuned for all that and more in hour two coming up next. Come together.
The most common form of treatment for the arthritic joints is normally cortisone injections and gel shots and over-the-counter medications. And most patients have tried all of that and are still in pain.
Every day, Dr. Aaron Wolkoff, a QC Kinetics medical director, meets patients who have exhausted every method to get relief. They've been told surgery is their only option.
They want to stay away from that path, and they come to us almost as a last hope. So we're using our our own body's properties to help manage pain, to help slow arthritis down, keep the patients active with no downtime, and getting back to what they enjoy doing. I mean, I love what I do.
QC Kinetics regenerative treatments from our board-certified providers help heal and restore aching joints. No surgery, harmful drugs, or downtime. Call for your free consultation today.
Call QC Kinetics, 317-559-PAIN. That's 317-559-PAIN. In Eagle Creek, Greenwood, and Carmel, 317-559-PAIN.
Prepare to amaze guests at your wedding with flowers from Gillespie Florists. Enjoy a free private wedding consultation led by an experienced Gillespie specialist. Learn arrangements for your bridal party, ceremony, reception, from cakes to delivery, and on-site design services from natural to the spectacular. Call Gillespie Florists at 273-1100. Shop Gillespie online at gillespieflorist.com or visit Gillespie at 10th and Raceway Road. Gillespie Florists. For all the flowers in your life.
Do you find yourself stuck in a timeshare? Get the real facts about the timeshare industry and your options for cancellation. Chuck McDell, founder of Wesley Financial Group, has put together a free information guide that reveals the secrets the timeshare industry doesn't want you to know, including the five ways to get rid of your timeshare. Call now and get this timeshare information guide absolutely free. Call 800-919-3200. That's 800-919-3200. 800-919-3200.
When was the last time you practiced your home fire escape plan? Be sure everyone in your family knows what to do if there's a fire. Get out, stay out. It's your fire safe response.
Coming up in 2 minutes, Ryan Hedrick reports on a big drug bust in Johnson County, plus why a couple YouTubers have to park it on the couch while following the Delphi murders case, and who exploded for the sycamores last night. I'm Kurt Darling. That and more coming up from the Technology Recycler Studios after Fox News Radio. You're listening to 93 WIBC, WIBC HD1 Indianapolis. It's 10 o'clock.
Getting out of Haiti. I'm Dave Anthony, Fox News. That is the plan for more Americans today, escaping the country overrun by gang violence. The U.S. government will get some more out. So will Florida. Republican Governor Ron DeSantis tells Fox.
It has been like pulling teeth to deal with some of these federal agencies. And the reality is you have an easier time getting into this country illegally than you do just to be rescued as a United States citizen.
Secretary of State Antony Blinken is in Egypt pushing a new ceasefire plan in Gaza that would include Hamas releasing all hostages as Israel keeps waging war, readying a controversial offensive the U.S. is warning against, going after Hamas leaders and militants in an area of Gaza filled with Palestinian civilians. Adding to the drama.
During an appearance on CNBC, Speaker Mike Johnson says he will invite Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu to Washington, D.C., to speak before the House of Representatives. This comes after Senate Majority Leader Chuck Schumer called on Israel to hold new elections after the war with Hamas winds down, declaring that Netanyahu had lost his way.
Fox's Ryan Schmelz. Congress has only today and tomorrow left to approve the final spending bill to fund the government through September and avert a partial shutdown this weekend. Lawmakers are now poring over the 1,000 pages in the bill released this morning before teeing up House and Senate votes. It's day two of a manhunt in Idaho for an escaped prisoner who got help breaking free out of a Boise hospital.
A gunman shot two officers and then a third officer was wounded when a responding officer returned fire. The now fugitive inmate, Skylar Meade, was serving a 20-year sentence for aggravated assault on a police officer. Authorities say Meade is a documented member of a prison gang.
Fox's Shanley Painter. The Justice Department has a news conference scheduled for an hour in an antitrust case reportedly related to Apple. Drama in Kazakhstan today. Russia's space agency aborted the launch of a mission to the International Space Station 20 seconds before liftoff. America's listening to Fox News.
93 WIBC Mobile News. On the level. On the go.
How much and how many? Radar is clear. It's 31 and cloudy downtown. I'm Kirk Darling. Here's what's trending at 10:02. Over a dozen people arrested in a drug bust yesterday in Johnson County. Ryan Hedrick reports.
Sheriff DeWayne Burgess says his detectives used informants and other means to seal a nine-month drug investigation that spanned multiple counties and resulted in lots of arrests.
You see your methamphetamines, your cocaine, marijuana is a normal drug.
Burgess says dozens of people are implicated in the case. Many of the people involved are from Indianapolis. Ryan Hedrick, 93 WIBC Mobile.
Global News.
A couple arrested in Kokomo and now they're facing charges after police found several types of drugs and an illegal gun inside their home. Celie Jackson and Todd Warren are accused of hiding several grams of fentanyl in a baby formula container. And the police also found evidence that they were making and selling counterfeit M30 pills made with fentanyl. Delphi Murders YouTuber Rick Snay was supposed to testify during Monday's contempt hearing, but a feud with another YouTuber got in the way.
What's going on, everybody? I am just now leaving the courthouse. Did I testify? No, they threw me out. And you know why? Because Noe got in my face.
Snay in a YouTube video Monday. Both men violated Judge Fran Gall's decorum order, and now they're both banned from all future Delphi court hearings. More people are getting in on the race to take over after Larry Bouchon leaves Congress. Dominic Kavanaugh is one of those people, and he tells Indy Politics the southern border is at the forefront of the minds of Hoosiers in southwestern Indiana.
That has been on everyone's mind in Indiana 8, and it's definitely one of the reoccurring issues with a lot of Republicans throughout the United States.
He also says inflation needs to be tamped down. Jason Kent had a career high at 35 points to come from behind win over SMU for the Indiana State Sycamores last night. The Trees now move on to the next round of the NIT with the victory, and they'll host Minnesota Sunday at 2:00. I'm Kurt Darling on the Level, on the Go, and on WIBC.com.
Still going for it, even with higher stroke risk from atrial fibrillation and a regular heartbeat not caused by a heart valve problem. Over a 3-year study, Eliquis apixaban tablets reduced stroke risk better than warfarin, and over 97% of Eliquis patients did not experience a stroke. A first stroke occurred in 2.9% of warfarin patients versus 2.3% of Eliquis patients.
Don't stop taking prescription Eliquis without asking your doctor. It may increase your stroke risk. Eliquis can cause serious and, in rare cases, fatal bleeding. Don't take Eliquis if you have an artificial heart valve, abnormal bleeding, or antiphospholipid syndrome. While taking, you may bruise more easily or take longer for bleeding to stop. A spinal injection while on Eliquis increases risk of blood clots, which may cause paralysis, the inability to move. Get medical help right away for unexpected bleeding, unusual bruising, or tingling, numbness, or muscle weakness. Medications such as aspirin products, NSAIDs, SSRIs, SNRIs, and blood thinners may increase bleeding risk. Tell your doctor about all planned medical or dental procedures. Learn more at Eliquis.com or call 1-855-ELIQUIS.
You're listening to Rob Kendall.
When we talk about sending money somewhere, mm-hmm. we're talking about printing the money because we have no money.
And Casey Daniels.
My government would never lie to me, would they?
On 93 WIBC.
Welcome back to 93 WIBC, the Kendall and Casey show. I'm Ethan Hatcher. That's Brian Baker giggling in the background. What's got you laughing there, Brian?
I love the casual manner in which Casey just throws that line away. My government would never lie to me, would they?
Yeah. Casey's dry, sardonic wit is a nice sprinkling on the Kendall and Casey show. First hour, of course, we were talking about the dynamite testimony of Tony Bobulinski offered at the House Oversight Committee congressional hearing regarding impeachment of the Biden crime family. Hunter Biden decided not to attend. And Brian, as you're very well aware, these congressional hearings are usually an opportunity for congressmen to grandstand and make a showy display and get a few sound bites to clip down and share on social media and present to their constituents and make it look like they're doing something. But it makes the overall presentation kind of a circus, probably to the detriment of serious contemplation. You know what I mean?
Yeah, definitely obscures the truth and keeps us from actually getting to what happened. And people, they see these shenanigans and it does. It becomes just a clown show and people lose sight of just how serious these charges truly are.
And for sure, Jared Muskowitz, congressman, was contributing to the clown show when he walked up to the congressional hearing wearing a Putin mask because he thinks he's some kind of comedian, and he was caught by reporters in the hallways of Congress.
Congressman, can you explain why you're wearing?
Oh, I just came to thank James Comer for taking all of our intelligence and using it in the committee. Maybe he can come see the technology in our grocery stores. Thank you.
Congressman, I think his behavior is kind of immature.
Because you're stupid.
You're stupid.
Yeah, you're a towel.
You're a towel.
Think about the amount of planning that went into being this stupid, Ethan. Yeah. I mean, was this a collective decision that was made amongst him and the other people that work in his office? Hey, this is a really great idea. Stuff like this, to me, is akin to when climate activists go out and glue their faces to the street. You lose the message that you are trying to get across when you act like a moron and look like a clown.
And it's not at all legitimate because Russia isn't involved in the congressional. This is a former business associate of Hunter Biden. It's a childish way of attempting to discredit very serious charges.
Indeed. You know, I always I get such a kick out of the party of spending the last 8 years chasing Donald Trump and just endless investigations, endless charges, and none of them ever pan out. And yet they continue to go back to that familiar narrative, don't they?
I'm glad that in one respect we are having these hearings because it might work out well for Donald Trump, because now the liberals claim not to even understand what RICO charges are. And as I understand it, that's one of the charges brought up against Donald Trump in Georgia. But AOC doesn't even think RICO is a crime.
Is it your testimony today that you personally witnessed President Joe Biden commit a crime?
I believe the fact that he was sitting with me while I was putting together a
business deal. Did you witness the president commit a crime? Is it your testimony today?
Yes.
And what crime have you witnessed?
How much time do I have to go through it?
It is simple. You name the crime. Did you watch him steal something?
Corruption statutes, RICO and conspiracy.
What is it? What is the crime, sir? Specifically.
You asked me to answer the question. I answered the question.
No.
RICO, you're obviously not familiar with. Corruption statutes.
Excuse me, sir. RICO is not a crime. It is a category. What is the
category of crimes that you're then charged?
You have charges.
A long hundred.
You have charges. Sir, please
name the exact statute under RICO.
Yes.
Well, it's funny. In this committee room, everyone's not here. There's over 80 lawyers that went to law school. Time.
It is crazy. We say to give a woman power is like to give a gun to a monkey. We have stopped doing that ever since the 1999 Astana Zoo massacre.
Never let one pass AOC. She's great. Isn't that fantastic? We have representation like that in Congress. Somebody should tell Donald Trump, apparently RICO isn't a crime. So just wipe that off the charges down there in Georgia. It's already taken care of. It's not an issue. It's certainly not something that's helped prosecute many mob members since the 1960s. No. Congresswoman Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez is simply a gem. A gem, Brian.
You know, I never in a million years would have thought that she would earn re-election. I thought the first time was a fluke. I thought she's such a moron. There's no way that anyone is going to get behind her and continue to support her. But I'll be dog. Here she is today, continuing to demonstrate her lack of intelligence again and again and again on the national stage.
Maybe they keep her around for the entertainment value.
Maybe. I will say, I mean, you know, she does put on a good show, and she sure knows how to appeal to her base.
It's true.
And play the game, so.
But her luck might be running thin because of the disastrous immigration policies and the porous border that's been invited by the Joe Biden administration and empowered by knuckleheads like Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez. I don't know if you've seen some of the footage from her district, but her district in New York has now turned into a third world country where they're holding open air bazaars. Stolen goods on the street. They're literally roasting rats on a spit in open air meat markets. Like it is insane. But yes, Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, this is the natural result of policies that you have helped promote.
We are in such a mess, aren't we?
Yes, we are.
I'm disappointed, too. You know, I've never been to New York City, and I was planning, you know, that we had it on the list for, you know, in the next year that we were going to go and make that trip, and I was finally going to get to see New York City. It's sort of like San Francisco. You know, it was a beautiful city at one time, and I loved it. Now I'm afraid to go. I'm terrified to go to New York. I don't even want to be in the middle of that mess. It seems like you're just gambling and taking unnecessary risk when you go to cities that have fallen apart under Democrat leadership, the way New York has, the way that Los Angeles has, it's just a nightmare.
Seems like New York kind of cycles because they were a death trap in the 1970s as well and were wrought with decay and dilapidation. And they eventually crawled and climbed their way out of that. And a post-Giuliani administration, New York was, I got to admit, Brian, a pretty decent place to walk around. I got to visit New York a couple of times in the late 2000s, early 2010s, and it was a decent place to be at the time. I wouldn't go there now when you have a decent chance of getting shot on the subway like you did in the 1970s. They cycle through, Brian. They cycle through. But yes, 2008 to 2012 was a pretty cool New York to see. And my favorite part about New York City is that no matter where you are, Chinese food is no more than 15 minutes away. At any time of the day or night, some intrepid young man in a bicycle will arrive with your freshly prepared Chinese food in styrofoam containers for your enjoyment. It's unparalleled.
It's heartening to know that there are still some businesses in operation in that state. That's wonderful.
Again, this has been about a decade now since I've been there, so they probably closed down too. They got driven out by the open-air meat markets, Brian.
Moving to Florida.
That Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez has brought to her doorstep. Now, returning to the conversation about the House Oversight Committee and the testimony offered by Tony Bobulinski, you heard in the first segment where he called Jamie Raskin a liar to his face. Mm-hmm. Jamie didn't really appreciate that, and he tried to bite back, and again, it backfired in spectacular fashion.
Mr. Bobulinski, please proceed. Okay. Please proceed. I apologize for the disruption from the minority.
Okay.
Well, Mr. Chairman, save his time, but he called members of this committee liars, and I just want to know whether the order and decorum requirements of House Rule 11 apply to witnesses appearing before the committee. Does it apply or does it not?
Should I address? I don't...
There's decorum from the members. We've asked for that. There's no language that I'm aware of pertaining to a witness.
Thank you.
Make sure we didn't waste any of his time on the opening statement. Mr. Bobulinski, I'm sorry for the disruption. Please continue your opening statement.
But
this whole place sucks.
That's right, it sucks.
Jamie Raskin didn't like that and tried to turn the rules against the witness. But no, Jamie, rules of Congress, not for the witnesses who have been invited to testify before them. I just like that he was trying to shut him up. Shut him up. He can't say that.
A moment of pure beauty and one of the few truly satisfying moments from the hearings.
Oh, yeah. And we got more to come. I really anticipate, hopefully, the Republicans will make hay out of these hearings in a vital election year, and if they don't push the impeachment through to the Senate, which we know it would die under Democrat control, they can make a win in the court of public opinion through hearings like this. Thanks for listening to 93 WIBC. This is the Kendall and Casey Show. Ethan and Brian filling in. Coming up next, we're going to air some interesting clips. Ron Paul, of course, was invited on by Tucker Carlson to discuss the deep state and who they are. But you'll hear it's not just some fantasy or imagining. The New York Times actually quite gleeful about the deep state and its existence, so much so that they made a video extolling its virtue. And we'll play that coming up next on 93 WIBC.
Tony Katz.
The cities have failed, become too difficult. Whether it be Chicago or San Francisco or New York or Indianapolis, they are connected by their progressive politics. And their progressive politics make things too difficult. It does not take a brain surgeon. It does not take any level of skill to note the connectivity. Just admit it.
Tony Katz, mornings 6 to 9 on 93 WIPC and WIPC.com.
So I'm proud to help deliver that for the people and the communities that matter most to me. With stronger, more resilient systems, better able to stand up to severe weather, and support for local businesses and jobs. It feels good knowing I'm helping build a smarter energy future for all of us.
Paid for by Duke Energy shareholders.
Indy's biggest party is back. Miller Lite Carb Day, Friday, May 24th, featuring George Thorogood and the Destroyers. With special guest, Gin Blossoms. Miller Lite Carb Day, May 24th at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. Concert pit and VIP tickets on sale now at IMS.com.
$5,000. That's the average amount of money people in the U.S. are now spending on gas in a year. $5,000. That's crazy. If you drive, you have to download Upside, the free app that gives you cash back every time you get gas. That's right. You can earn real cash back with Upside just by buying the gas you're already buying. You can literally start earning cash back today.
I use Upside every time I fill up, and top users make $200 to $300 per month.
You're putting gas in your car anyway. Why not get real cash back? If you like free money, download Upside.
I'm saving the cash I earn from using Upside to help pay for a vacation later this year.
Download the free Upside app now to earn cash back every time you buy gas. Use promo code STEER25 to get an extra 25 cents per gallon on your first tank. You can cash out anytime right to your bank, PayPal, or a gift card for Amazon and other brands. Just download the free Upside app and use promo code STEER25 for a 25 cents per gallon bonus on your first tank. That's code STEER25 for a 25 cents per gallon bonus.
Go where the pros go. Drexel Interiors for Timberlake kitchen and bath cabinets. Visit Drexel's new design center on 146th Street at River Road or on North Shadeland. DrexelIN.com.
I know we got to get to a segment, but right now I'm just jamming out to Kevin's bump music selection.
Yeah, on, Kevin. Nice selection.
Trying to play some 60s today.
It's always nice when we have a competent producer at the helm, and you have just impeccable taste in classic rock and good old music.
Thank you. I like that
about you, Kev.
Appreciate it.
See, I always associate this song with the Blues Brothers trying to flee the police before they crash through a mall. Greatest scene in a movie ever.
It's been a minute since I've seen Blues Brothers. I got to watch that again. Thanks for listening. Go ahead.
Sat down and showed it to my daughter, and we got 5 minutes in, and my wife put a stop to that really quickly.
Yeah, daughter might be a little bit young to enjoy that. Give it a couple of years, though. Although, I used to watch Big Lebowski with my stepdaughter, so.
Thanks for listening
to 93 WIBC. This segment, let's wade through the muck and the slime and the grime and the mire. We're talking about the deep state, Brian, and Tucker Carlson. He's been having some really interesting conversations with people, and I like what he's doing on the Twitter machine because he's got a little bit more room to just have a casual conversation like we are now, and it's produced some really fascinating interactions. One of them he recently had with Ron Paul, who he invited on the program, and they talked for a moment about who the deep state is. And I think Dr. Paul could have done a little better, but he does hint at the issue.
Who is the deep state, by the way?
Well, I don't have a list in front of me.
I have no idea.
Well, I think it's people who have tremendous power, and they happen to hate liberty, and they happen to be people that have endorsed, because of their wealth, they've been able to get along well, and because of that, they become nihilists. They don't believe in truth. Truth is impossible to reach, and there's a whole philosophy of nihilism that you can't believe in truth, and so it's rejected. But everybody wants something to believe in, so they believe in themselves. These people who have a lot of influence, whether they're the president of a university, which is like not too long ago, didn't we have a few professors show up on television that just were terrible, and they were the ones in charge of our kids.
It can't be bargained with. It can't be reasoned with. It doesn't feel pity or remorse or fear, and it absolutely will not stop ever until you are dead.
That's what the deep state is. The deep state is relentless. The deep state are the unelected bureaucrats, the power behind the office that manipulate the machinations of government for their own interests. That's what the deep state is. So I think Dr. Paul could have offered a better working definition there, but I understand he was put on the spot. He does talk about a very real phenomenon, though. Wouldn't you agree, Brian?
Yes, I did. And thank you for clarifying, because I was just getting ready to come back and say, okay, I've listened to this entire clip of Ron Paul telling us what the deep state is, and maybe I'm just not smart enough, but I still have no idea what he's talking about.
Yeah. Well, I think he could have, like I said, I think he could have offered a better working definition, but it's not just some conspiracy that they're bandying about. And I kid you not, Brian, this was absolutely pathetic. The New York Times ran an article explaining why the deep state is actually amazing, titled, "Turns out the deep state is actually kind of awesome." And they try to humanize these bureaucrats and say that they're just like you and me and trying to make the world a better place. Here's the filth coming out of the New York Times.
You want to replace your own water pipes? You got the skills to launch an asteroid deflecting spacecraft? No. That's why your tax dollars pay experts like Radhika and Scott. Important work like this is happening all over America. From helping 2 million victims of the opioid crisis, to engineering major breakthroughs in nuclear fusion, and helping make hearing aids affordable for 30 million people. Yep, the deep state is hard at work making America great. Just because we don't know about it doesn't make it suspicious. These guys work for you, but Trump wants them working for him.
Trump wants to fire at least thousands of these people that he calls pejoratively the deep state.
Schedule F would allow Trump to fire up to 50,000 of them and replace them with like-minded people.
Sometimes it's really hard to read the newspaper where, you know, you feel like we as public servants are being attacked.
Now, this doesn't mean that Americans can't have different ideas about how big the federal government should be. After all, there's no shortage of examples of real government overreach and overspend. But Trump's teaching us to expect the worst from people in government.
Yes!
When the truth is, they're actually some of our best.
No!
What you just said is one of the most insanely idiotic things I have ever heard. At no point in your rambling, incoherent response were you even close to anything that could be considered a rational thought. Everyone in this room is now dumber for having listened to it. I award you no points, and may God have mercy on your soul.
So see, Brian, they're just people like you and me trying to make the world a better place. And do you want to replace your own water lines?
Oh, my goodness. Yeah, it is fascinating to me that they put forth this narrative and say, you know, they have all of this power to do good, and it never once occurs to them how that can go very, very wrong very, very quickly. But I have to say, yeah, the best and the brightest, not something that you generally associate with the politicians in Washington, D.C.
I'm glad that you mentioned how the power that government wields can easily be abused. And that is the real nefarious nature of the deep state and how it operates. And we have proof in action from a more visible source, Ketanji Brown Jackson, musing from the Supreme Court that the government is too constrained by limitations of the First Amendment. These are the feelings that are echoed by the deep state.
Justice Jackson?
So my biggest concern is that your view has the First Amendment hamstringing the government in significant ways in the most important time periods. What would you have the government do? I've heard you say a couple times that the government can post its own speech, but in my hypothetical, kids, this is not safe, don't do it, is not going to get it done. And so I guess some might say that the government actually has a duty to take steps to protect the citizens of this country, and you seem to be suggesting that that duty cannot manifest itself in the government encouraging or even pressuring platforms to take down harmful information. So can you help me? Because I'm really worried about that, because you've got the First Amendment operating in an environment of threatening circumstances from the government's perspective, and you're saying that the government can't interact with the source of those problems.
Stop it! Stop it! Please! I beg you! It's a sin! It's a sin! It's a sin!
Doesn't that that make the hairs on the back of your neck stand up that Ketanji Brown Jackson is thirsting so vocally for the government to be able to pressure private entities to take things off their website and to be able to stymie their free speech? It's literally frightening. That right there, what we just played, that's the deep state. That's the deep state that the freaking New York Times was fetishizing.
Pure evil. And she represents the views of millions of people, Ethan, millions of people that have gone wayward and are backwards in their thinking and are easily led down this path to, well, look at all the good that it could do without ever considering the balance. And this is, you know, this is how it starts, man. And believe me, the voices of the rational and the people that are speaking up for truth, they're becoming fewer and fewer.
Well, and think about how frightening an entity the deep state and the government would be if it was actually helmed by somebody competent in their machinations of evil. But fortunately, in that regard, we only have Joe Biden leading the country right now, and he's a senile dolt. In fact, he doesn't even know what major cities are in America.
If I forget, we drove out to the airport and put you on Air Force One, you said you had a prescription you needed filled. And it was an American company that made it. I'd say, okay, let's fly to Toronto or to Berlin or to London or to Rome or any major city in America. I'll get you that same prescription filled in those cities for 40 to 60% less than it costs you at a pharmacy here.
I'm particularly glad that these lovely children are here today to hear that speech. Not only was it authentic frontier gibberish, it expressed a courage little seen in this day and age.
Famous American cities like London, Berlin, Toronto. You think Biden is a few tools short of a toolbox?
He is, and I still argue that it is that it's elder abuse, man. I just think it's shameful. But yeah, you know, campaign season, as we ramp up and get closer and closer to November, expect more of these wonderful little sound clips from the Biden campaign. And I just, you can't get enough of it. In the middle of all the horror, at least we have some moments of levity when we're able to just give Joe Biden the opportunity to speak.
Thank God we don't have more competent leadership in charge of the deep state, because that would be truly frightening indeed. Thanks for listening to the Kendall and Casey Show. Unfortunately, I got Kurt Darling shooting daggers at me. He says, we need to get to the news.
Why
do
is that
now.
Unfortunate?
Do it now, says Kurt. We're going to cut to the news in just a moment. Thanks for listening to 93 WIBC.
The cold days are almost past. Warmer spring is getting close, but that means more rain is coming too. It's more important than ever to make sure your home is protected from the ground up. Did you know that spring showers can cause crawl space issues? If you've noticed water or mold rot in your crawl space, sagging or bouncy floors, or musty smells, the experts from Indiana Foundation Service can help tackle the problem before it's too late. It may seem overwhelming to you, but rest assured, they are experts at taking care of any of your home's foundation problems. They'll work with you to find the permanent solution your crawl space needs to stay dry this spring and year-round. Now is the right time to fix your crawl space issues. Don't wait another day. Visit IndianaFoundation.com to schedule your free inspection now. That's IndianaFoundation.com. Indiana Foundation Service. There's a reason they are the trusted local experts.
Indiana Foundation Service. Reliability from the ground up.
93 WIBC Mobile News. On the level. On the go.
Wiping it clean. It's 31 and mostly cloudy downtown. I'm Kirk Darling. Here's what's trending at 10:30. More students are getting debt relief from President Biden. A new announcement from the White House says that Biden is canceling nearly $6 billion in student loan debt for about 78,000 public service workers, including teachers, nurses, and firefighters. The announcement says those getting the debt relief will receive an email signed by the president. Israel's prime minister may be coming to Washington soon. Fox's Ryan Schmelz.
During an appearance on CNBC, Speaker Mike Johnson says he will invite Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu to Washington, D.C. to speak before the House of Representatives. This comes after Senate Majority Leader Chuck Schumer called on Israel to hold new elections after the war with Hamas winds down, declaring that Netanyahu had lost his way. The invitation is sure to anger some progressive Democrats. On Capitol Hill, Ryan Schmelz, Fox News.
I'm Kirk Darling, on the level, on the go, and on WIBC.com.
Everyone wants energy that's reliable and affordable. I've been a Duke Energy line worker here in Indiana for almost 20 years. So I'm proud to help deliver that for the people and the communities that matter most to me. With stronger, more resilient systems, better able to stand up to severe weather, and support for local businesses and jobs. It feels good knowing I'm helping build a smarter energy future for all of us.
Paid for by Duke Energy shareholders.
The deals and specials are sizzling hot. It's the Central Indiana Gun and Knife Show this Saturday and Sunday at the Stoutfield National Guard Armory on West Minnesota Street. The best dealers in the region, hundreds of tables, just $6 for adults, kids 12 and under free. Must be 18 or accompanied by an adult. Buy, sell, trade this Saturday, 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. and Sunday, 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. at the Stoutfield National Guard Armory. For more info, visit centralindianagunshows.com.
Having health insurance is important. So, if you or anyone in your family has Medicaid or CHIP, listen up. Check your mail for a renewal form from your state. Complete the form and mail it back right away so you don't lose your coverage. If you do lose Medicaid or CHIP, visit healthcare.gov to see if you're eligible to enroll in a low-cost, quality health plan. Keep your family covered. Paid for by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services.
Indy's leader in patio installation is now offering a new driveway package. Schedule a free estimate today at IndyDecorativeConcrete.com. That's IndyDecorativeConcrete.com.
You're listening to the Kendall and Casey Show on 93 WIPC.
Ethan Hatcher and Brian Baker filling in on the show. I wanted to, this segment, discuss the concept of lowering standards for higher achievement in equity. Of course, recently, the issue of staffing at police departments has become a major issue in cities around America, and even in counties here in the state of Indiana. It seems like the natural course of action following the Defund the Police movement widely broadcast through 2020, but that's neither here nor there. Now, they are lowering standards in order to achieve higher levels of equity, things that have already paid off so well in the airline industry. Right, Brian? It's working out great.
Yeah, not quite. We've seen this happen across the board in many industries, and now it's coming to one that is just terrifying to me.
Now it's coming to police departments, where in Nashville, Tennessee, they are piloting a great new program that would eliminate ability requirements for officers so they can bump up female participation. Isn't that wonderful news?
It's a male-dominated profession, so women are scared to take that step, maybe thinking that they're not able to do it, but you can do it if you have that right mindset.
It's a mindset the Metro Police Department hopes more women will have. Their goal, a 30% female police force. Last year, it was 11%. This year, it's 13%.
And is it even attainable?
I think we're definitely growing, so if we can just keep that momentum going, I believe that it is definitely attainable.
Commander Tiffany Gibson is Metro's first female director of training. She says among the biggest changes they've made to help attract recruits, especially women, no more physical ability tests. Now trainees must pass a physical agility test designed to mirror tasks in the field. They've also added lactation rooms for nursing moms to all 8 precincts.
I'm going to be honest with you. I hate this place, this zoo, this prison, this reality, whatever you want to call it. I can't stand it any longer.
I'm so done, Brian. Lactation rooms for police officers? Maybe if you have an infant child you're bringing with you, they shouldn't be in the police department. I do not want an infant child on a drug run. I do not want an infant child with a police officer having to respond to a domestic abuse situation. This is insanity. I'm
granted,
so done.
Yeah, no, no, no. not an ideal situation, but you know, the way that they are presenting this is really just a politically acceptable smokescreen, because we know what's really happening. We had the Summer of Love, and a lot of really great officers who served with honor and with pride and with dignity decided, you know what, I've had enough, and they got out of the business. They moved on to civilian jobs. I've got friends that are police officers, had been police officers for 20 years, and they finally just decided, you know what? I don't care if I have to lose $20,000 per year in income. I'm not putting up with this anymore. So, yeah, I mean, they're desperate to get recruits and just get warm bodies. And, you know, I saw how that affected McDonald's when they started lowering their standards and said, we just got to get warm bodies. But now we're talking about the people who are actually charged with enforcing the law and protecting us and our families. It's terrifying.
Yes, I want officers to have ability. I want them to be able to pass those ability tests. And it doesn't matter what your mindset is, ladies. You need to be able to pass a certain level of criteria. And if you can, more power to you. I think female police officers on the force are a wonderful thing, but not these artificial percentages like, oh, well, it looks like we need a 30% female representation in the police force. Doesn't matter if they can't do the job. And these are really dangerous situations you're putting these ladies to, or unqualified men for that matter, if they can't pass the ability test. I don't want some fatso responding to a dire situation when he can't adequately be able to perform the job.
Yeah, but if it's that or no one showing up, which do you choose there, Ethan? See, well, that's right. Where the dilemma is.
Well, that's exactly the problem. And this isn't just liberal cities and liberal states. It's also happening right here in the state of Indiana. This shocked me when I saw the headline cross WIBC's website that Washington County's Sheriff Department will no longer staff overnight hours from 11 to 7 a.m. Well, folks, I guess go out to Washington County during 11 to 7 if you want to go commit your crimes. For a blank slate.
Wow.
This is wild.
Wow.
Isn't that isn't that wild in Indiana from 11 to 7? 8 hours where the sheriff's department, nobody there, nobody to take the call. If you're in an emergency situation, screw you. I guess you better strap up, get a gun.
Disastrous. And this all has a trickle-down effect. You start driving out citizens, you start driving out residents, you start driving out businesses. People flee because ultimately we want to feel safe and secure. And, you know, it will have a ripple effect that is going to be just absolutely catastrophic. But it's startling to me that we've reached this. You know, I can remember it being in Los Angeles, and just it blew my mind that you could call 911 and 9 times out of 10, you're getting a busy signal. Now we are seeing that kind of stuff happen in every state in our union.
Yeah, it's happening in Pennsylvania, too, where Pittsburgh PD have also abandoned their citizens during the overnight hours, promising a similar window of vacancy for local police precincts.
Officers will not respond unless it's an emergency. Also, between the hours of 3 a.m. and 7 a.m., there will be no officers at any of the 6 stations throughout the city. Call boxes that link directly to 911 have been installed for people to use in case of an emergency. And during the overnight shift, there will be as few as 20 officers to cover the entire city. The chief said today the data supports that.
Yes, it's enough to cover the entire city in those hours when we have 8% of the time people are calling.
That's garbage.
And I mean that sincerely.
20 officers to cover the entire city of Pittsburgh. Have you seen the open-air drug markets that are going on in Pittsburgh? Have you seen the zombies rummaging through the streets? My God! And now, if you go to a police precinct, there's just nobody there. If you need to take shelter, if you're in a threatening situation, you know how police stations are supposed to be a safe place? They even have that yellow sign right outside. Mm-hmm. Not in Pittsburgh. No safe shelter there. No safe harbor there. If you're fleeing a domestic violence situation, screw you. Get out of Pittsburgh. Leave now.
Man. Man, oh, well, you know what? What we predicted and we all knew was coming is finally happening. And I want to know what constitutes an emergency. They will not respond unless it's an emergency.
Yeah.
How are we going to categorize emergencies? And will the line continue to get moved as we have fewer and fewer people to actually respond to crimes that are in progress?
I'm glad you picked up on that point. What constitutes an emergency? And does it even matter if you don't have anybody at the police station to staff to deal with these problems? But, Brian, it gets even better. Because you know how you just heard there that they weren't staffing from 3 a.m. to 7 a.m., right? You know, 4 hours of, you know, vacant police stations. Surely that, you know, that's bad. But it gets even worse. Because some stations aren't even opening until 4:30 in the afternoon. Over 12 hours of completely vacant police stations, as reported by their local news.
Showing up to the Zone 3 police station in Allentown before 4:30 this afternoon, out of luck. Several people tell Channel 11 no one was there to take their complaints, and in one case, a protection from abuse order. 11 Investigates has widely reported on staffing issues at the department, leading to changes. Channel 11's Rich Pierce is outside of Zone 3 police station after finding out how this happened.
Zone 3 here already operates on limited hours. It's actually closed from 3 a.m. to 7 a.m., but today it was even longer, and police tell us that could happen anytime.
We spoke to one woman on the phone who did not want to be identified. She told us she tried filing a theft complaint this afternoon, but couldn't.
Do you think there's an expectation that somebody is there to speak to?
Definitely.
Look, if you hate cops just because they're cops, the next time you get in trouble, call a crackhead.
Yeah, just call a social worker, right? Isn't that the way it works?
Yeah, that, isn't that funny where they're allocating our tax dollars? I'm, you know, infinite money for these social programs and free giveaways and hotel stays for illegal immigrants, but then no money for police and no police! No police at the police station! If you have a domestic violence order of protection, screw you! If somebody's stealing stuff from your house, screw you! And this is the government that's supposed to represent you, but I mean, I guess it does, because in the city of Pittsburgh, certainly a lot of those knuckleheads voted for this. So anybody who's sane that's left, leave. I don't know what else to tell you.
By the same party that doesn't want you to have a handgun to protect you and your family. Jeez.
And then, call the police. Call the police, they say. But then the police aren't there. So what do you have left?
Well, they're not there, or they're too busy. They're prioritizing a call that's also an emergency, but it's a bigger emergency than yours. So sorry. Yeah, I guess that's the deal, right? If in a best case scenario in a situation like this, Ethan, if you are going to be in an emergency situation, and you know, God willing, it never happens. But if you are and you're in the city of Pittsburgh, you want your emergency to be a really horrific emergency because you want to make sure that somebody shows up to help you.
And in some cases, the police are actively being weaponized against the citizenry. If you're not being abandoned, then you're being assaulted. We're going to play some clips in the next hour of a woman in New York City who was arrested for entering her own home that she legally possesses, that she has a valid deed for, that she pays the taxes and the utilities for, and the police arrested her. So if you're not being abandoned, you're assaulted. Leave liberal cities now. Thanks for listening to 93 WIBC, Kendall and KC Show. Coming up next, an item of interest for me, and I wanted to share and celebrate with you, Brian. Big changes coming in the world of Jehovah's Witnesses. Now, women will be allowed to wear pants. We'll tell you more about it coming up next.
Tonight on the Tony Kinnecast, Jerry Lopez joins us for awful tweets and people pretend to get excited about vice president picks. Tune in at 7 p.m. right here or the podcast anytime.
Do you get sinus infections, congestion, sinus pressure and pain above your eyes, below your eyes, sinus headaches? You've gone to the doctor, you've visited urgent care over and over again, and it's always the same thing.
Oh, I know. Let's try antibiotics and nasal sprays.
But the sinus infections keep coming back. The good news? relief is possible. How? A minimally invasive procedure done in the office of Indianapolis Sinus Center called balloon sinuplasty. Imagine the relief of not having to deal with your sinus infections anymore. Set an appointment today with Indianapolis Sinus Center and find out if balloon sinuplasty is the solution for you. Call 317-528-9650. 317-528-9650. That's 317-528-9650.
I have diabetes. I'm at risk for pneumococcal pneumonia.
I have asthma. I'm at risk too.
If you're 19 or older with chronic conditions like asthma, diabetes, COPD, or heart disease, or are 65 or older, you are at increased risk for pneumococcal pneumonia. Ask your doctor or pharmacist about Prevnar 20, pneumococcal 20-valent conjugate vaccine, a Pfizer vaccine that can help protect you against pneumococcal pneumonia in just one dose. Even if you've already been vaccinated with other pneumonia vaccines, Prevnar 20 may help provide added protection. Prevnar 20 is approved for adults to help prevent infections from 20 strains of the bacteria that cause pneumococcal pneumonia. Continued approval may depend on a supportive study. Don't get Prevnar 20 if you've had a severe allergic reaction to the vaccine or its ingredients. Adults with weakened immune systems may have a lower response to the vaccine. Side effects include pain and swelling at the injection site, fatigue, headache, muscle, and joint pain. For full prescribing information, please call 1-855-213-2138 or visit Prevnar20.com.
Jefferson Shreve stepped up to fight when no one else would. He put it all on the line. And the liberals smeared him for it with ads like this.
Donald Trump and Jefferson Shreve. He's an original supporter of Donald Trump.
They attacked Shreve for being a conservative.
Jefferson Shreve, an A rating from the NRA.
Attacked him for being a loyal Republican.
Look who was there. Jefferson Shreve. He was proud to be on the Trump campaign and proud of his own A rating from the NRA.
All because Shreve would get tough, back the blue, and stop the crime. But we don't have to accept their lawlessness at our border, in our suburbs, in our state. Because Jefferson Shreve is running for Congress, and he's a fighter for law, order, and a secure border. Jefferson Shreve for Congress.
I'm Jefferson Shreve, and I approve this message.
Paid for by Shreve for Congress.
Expand your backyard living space with an Indy Decorative Concrete patio. Did you know that on average, our patios are less expensive than a wood deck? With a longer life, less maintenance, more color options, and more texture and pattern selections. We can even stamp your patio to look like wood. You can get a much larger and longer-lasting entertainment space for your investment. Indy Decorative Concrete, the patio experts, changing the way Indy thinks about concrete.
Dents happen. There's a whole lot of stuff that can mess up the look of your vehicle. Don't paint your car. Go PDR with Killa Dent Removal. PDR is paintless dent removal that saves your factory finish and is way less invasive than traditional body shop repairs. And it's faster, too, sometimes same day. Google Killa Dent Removal and check out the reviews and photos. Then schedule your repair. Hail, baseballs, kids, fender benders, shopping carts, flying cows, angry exes, and anything else that leaves dents. Don't paint your car. Go PDR with Killa Dent Removal.
Getting quality employees to fill positions in your company is essential, but finding those people can be a major hassle unless you use ZipRecruiter. ZipRecruiter makes finding quality people a breeze. ZipRecruiter's advanced technology identifies candidates with the right skills, sends you great matches, then you can easily invite them to apply. 4 out of 5 employers who post on ZipRecruiter get a quality candidate within the first day. See for yourself. Go to ZipRecruiter.com/free to try ZipRecruiter for free. That's ZipRecruiter.com/free.
In the days of my youth, I was told what it means to be a man.
Welcome back to 93 WIBC. This is the Kendall and Casey Show. Ethan Hatcher joined by Brian Baker. Together, we're filling in for Rob Kendall and Casey Daniels, and we've been having a fantastic time. If you've missed a moment of the show, make sure to catch the podcast uploaded to WIBC.com. You can also find my podcast there from Saturday night on The Circle. I heartily recommend you check those out. This segment, I wanted to discuss some major changes that are coming to the religious Christian cult of Jehovah's Witnesses. Now, Brian, I'm sure you know already. I was raised as a Jehovah's Witness, so these kind of updates are of great interest to me, and perhaps they'll fascinate the outside world who would query why people have to expressly be granted permission to just say hello to former members at church. But that was a recent exception outlined by the governing body of Jehovah's Witnesses.
What if a disfellowship person comes to a congregation meeting? Under our current arrangement, we don't say a greeting to individuals who've been removed from the congregation. However, the governing body has decided that publishers can use their Bible-trained conscience to decide whether to give a simple greeting and welcome a disfellowshipped individual who attends a congregation meeting.
Hi, so good to see you here.
Thank you.
While we wouldn't have an extended conversation or socialize with such a person, we do not need to ignore him completely.
I have decided to shun Andy Bernard for the next 3 years, which I'm looking forward to. It's an Amish technique. It's like slapping someone with silence. I was shunned from the age of 4 until my 6th birthday for not saving the excess oil from a can of tuna.
Great news, Brian. I could hear your incredulity. You think it's a bit of a stretch to be granted permission to say hello, but not have an extended conversation. No extended conversations, but you can say hello. Isn't that great?
Well, it sounds somewhat Scientology-esque, but I was going to say at the beginning of the segment, I know that this is your background, but you know, for the uninformed, and that would be me, because most people, I think we think of the Jehovah's Witnesses, the folks that just, you know, show up once a quarter and bang on your door. But sure, what are some of the primary differences between Jehovah's Witnesses versus, say, Christians, Protestants? What's what are some of the differing beliefs that really set them apart? Because it seems to me quite cultish.
Jehovah's Witnesses believe that they are the only true Christian religion. So they do not experience any fealty with other Christian branches. Those are pagan organizations. Jehovah's Witnesses do not believe in the heavenly hope for most of their members. That is restricted to a limit of 144,000 special chosen by God who will be in the heavens, and the rest of humanity is promised an eternal life on earth. They also believe in rejecting medical science like blood transfusions. They incorporate ritualistic shunning. They don't celebrate birthdays or Christmas parties. There's lots of very key differences between Jehovah's Witnesses and the rest of Christianity.
That sounds like a whole lot of fun. Sign me up for that club.
Oh, it was a great time growing up, Brian. Let me tell you what a wild, good time that was.
How did you break out?
Through research. My way out of the organization was deeper into the organization. I started combing through decades of their literature and found key contradictions with themselves and with scripture that finally allowed me to make my exit.
Did it shake your entire foundation?
Yes, it did. I spent like 2 weeks basically not sleeping and just researching the Bible and researching the Watchtower literature. And on the outside of that, I came to the inescapable conclusion, these people are a cult and I need to leave.
Wow.
And now they are moving forward. They're changing with the times. Now, according to the governing body, and this is a big, big, big change, Brian. Women, you can wear pants at church.
The governing body has asked me to read the following announcement. The governing body has decided that sisters may choose to wear slacks when participating in the ministry and when attending Christian meetings, assemblies, and conventions. If a sister chooses to wear slacks on such occasions, they should not be casual, but dignified, modest, and appropriate. When a sister has a part on the program, she should wear a skirt or a dress, if that is the standard of dress in that land. Of course, some sisters may choose to wear a skirt or a dress even when they do not have a part on the program. In addition, brothers may choose not to wear a tie or a jacket when participating in the ministry and when attending Christian meetings, assemblies, and conventions. If a brother chooses not to wear a tie or a jacket on such occasions, he should dress in a manner that is appropriate, modest, and dignified, not casual.
Excuse me, are y'all with the cult?
We're not a cult. We're an organization that promotes love. And
yeah, this is it.
Well, God bless them. They're changing with the times, embracing business casual for services and being out in the field. And well, you know, I'll tell you, man, that seems like they're focused on all the right things that are really going to have a huge impact on helping their fellow man.
It's going to be hard to spot the Jehovah's Witnesses because they used to stand out in their cheap suits and their clean shaven faces. But now you don't have to wear a tie. Women can wear pants. Men can grow a beard. Cats and dogs are getting along together. I mean, it's complete pandemonium.
Is it when you leave the Jehovah's Witness church, is it like Scientology? Do the members come after you?
Yes, you know, yes, they will harass you. It depends on whether you left. If you were just kicked out but you still want to rejoin, then they'll try and love bomb you. But if you're an apostate like me who actively speaks against the organization, then they'll come after you. But the nice thing about allowing women to wear pants is now all the brothers have an opportunity to enjoy a fine posterior.
I like big butts, I cannot lie. You other brothers can't deny. When a girl walks in with an itty-bitty waist and a round thing in your face, you get sprung, 'cause you noticed that butt was stuffed. You pull up tough, deep in the jeans she's wearing.
Stay tuned to 93 WIBC. This is the Kendall and Casey Show.
Have you ever felt like you're not good enough? Like you're always falling short? The Bible tells us that we are all sinners and that our sin separates us from God. But God loves us so much that he sent his son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for our sins. Jesus took our place. He became the great exchange. He took our sin upon himself and he gave us his righteousness. Hi, this is Pastor Micah Beckwith. This Easter, March 31st at Life Church, we want to invite you to celebrate the great exchange with us. Go to lifechurchin.com to learn more about our Easter service times.
With the weather changing, March is a critical time to check your home's windows. If yours are cracked or leaking and won't open or stay open, then it's time to call the pros at Window Nation. Right now, for every two windows you buy, you'll get two windows free. There's no limit to how much you could save. Plus, you could save even more with zero down, zero interest, and zero payments for 24 months. Window Nation's windows come with a lifetime warranty and can be installed in 1 day or less.
With proven quality service, it's no wonder thousands of homeowners have trusted Window Nation for their homes. And you can too. If your old windows and high energy costs from this past winter are cutting deep into your finances, don't miss out. With this unlimited deal, buy two, get two free, plus zero down, zero interest, and no payments for 24 months. You can't afford to wait. 866-90-NATION or go to windownation.com. Schedule your free in-home estimate.
Go where the pros go. Drexel Interiors for Timberlake Kitchen and Bath Cabinets. Visit Drexel's new design center on 146th Street at River Road or on North Shadeland. DrexelIN.com.
Coming up in 2 minutes, the number of people arrested in Johnson County Wednesday, and John Herrick reports on what this couple was doing with fentanyl in Kokomo. I'm Kirk Darling. That and more coming up from the Technology Recycler Studios after Fox News Radio. You're listening to 93 WIBC, WIBC HD1 Indianapolis. It's 11 o'clock.
He's a white supremacist prison gang member.
I'm Dave Anthony, Fox News, and he's still on the run for a second day with the man who helped him escape from a hospital in Boise, Idaho.
Skylar Meade was serving a 20-year sentence for aggravated assault of a law enforcement officer with a firearm enhancement. He also had a string of other crimes, including grand theft and several drug cases.
Fox's Dan Springer.
After getting treated, he was being walked out to the ambulance in the carport of the emergency department when an accomplice started shooting at the corrections officers, hitting two of them. Now, a third was later hit by friendly fire. fire after Boise police responded. Police now say Nicholas Umfenauer was the shooter.
A police officer was shot and wounded this morning in Fort Lauderdale, Florida. He's said to be stable with injuries not considered life-threatening. More Americans will get flown out of Haiti today, not just by the U.S. government, also by the state of Florida operating its own rescue flights. But Republican Governor Ron DeSantis tells Fox,
we are not getting great cooperation with much of the federal government, unfortunately. Of course, we did similar rescue flights in Israel. The difference with that was the Israeli government was very supportive of what we were doing. Right. Haiti is a much different story.
Speaking of Israel, Secretary of State Antony Blinken will go there tomorrow. He's in Egypt now, pushing a plan to stop the war against Hamas in Gaza.
He's also confirmed the U.S. submitted a draft U.N. resolution calling for an immediate ceasefire linked to the release of hostages. The use of the word immediate is a shift. The United States previously blocked a resolution with that language.
That's Fox's Jonathan Savage. We're waiting news from the Justice Department this morning on an antitrust case against Apple, which just put out a statement saying the government's involvement in technology design threatens the company, hindering Apple's ability to create products. On Wall Street, it's another record-setting day. The Dow and the Nasdaq hitting new all-time highs. The Dow, a little over 100 points away from 40,000. America's listening to Fox News.
93 WIPC Mobile News. On the level. On the go.
How many were caught? It's cloudy and 32 on Monument Circle. I'm Kurt Darling for Window Nation. Here's what's trending at 11:02. Lots of people arrested in a drug bust in Johnson County yesterday.
Yesterday, we picked up 15, and I know that investigators from the three agencies are still working together to get the rest of the folks, but we also have some of those folks that are sitting in other jails currently.
Johnson County Sheriff Dwayne Burgess says in all, 32 people are implicated in this particular sting all over the county and a few others as well, in which they also found a lot of meth and pot, amongst other things. Fentanyl, lots of money, and an illegal gun. Those were just a few of the things that were found in a home in Kokomo and with a couple this week.
And those two people, Seeley Jackson and Todd Warren, were arrested on several drug and child neglect charges. I'm John Herrick. The Howard County Sheriff's Office says both of those people were making and selling fentanyl, and they even found fentanyl in a baby formula container in their home. Police confiscated all of that, along with the gun, which is a Glock. Jackson and Warren were taken to the Howard County Jail. John Herrick, 93 WIBC Mobile News.
You likely won't see any rain today, but tomorrow...
So we do have some the potential for rain chances on Friday.
Casey Fusen with the National Weather Service says winds will be less intense today, too, but the risk of fire is still very present, so be careful if you have to burn anything outside. The DNR is planning to release three bald eagles after taking care of them. Conservation officers began caring for one of the eagles after finding them malnourished near Alfordsville on Monday, which is not far from Washington. Wildlife rehabilitators are now in charge of taking care of the birds, and they expect to release the three birds back into the wild soon. Indiana State beat Southern Methodist 101-92 in the first round of the NIT Wednesday. Jason Kent had 35 points.
He doesn't want to prove people that we're capable of winning it. You know, the whole team knows it's elimination time. And we just want to play our heart out and try to get as far as we can.
The Sycamores now hosting Minnesota inside the Holman Center on Saturday, or rather Sunday. I'm Kurt Darling. On the level, on the go, and on WIBC.com.
Do you plan to file for Social Security? Be careful here because you could set off a chain reaction of events with your taxes, IRA, and 401k withdrawals, spousal benefits, and even your Medicare premiums. And this could needlessly cost you a small fortune. Hey, it's Hammer and Nigel. Learn how you could avoid this with a free customized Social Security analysis from Bill Demery, your retirement guy, right here in Indy.
So if you've saved more than $200,000 for retirement and have not yet filed for Social Security, you've got to call Bill Demery right now. He'll give you a free analysis. Free, but you got to call 317-648-5120. 317-648-5120. Social Security, it's complicated, but Bill Demery will make it make sense for you. I've met with Bill, he's the best. 317-648-5120. Bill Demery, your retirement guy.
You're listening to Rob Kendall.
When we talk about sending money somewhere, mm-hmm. we're talking about printing the money because we have no money.
And Casey Daniels.
My government would never lie to me, would they?
On 93 WIPC.
Good morning, Indianapolis. This is the Kendall and Casey Show. It's 11:05 here at 93 WIBC, and we've been having a fantastic time together here on the air with producer Kev on the board, beep, 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 pushing the buttons and doing the things to make the show function. I am your fill-in host, Ethan Hatcher, joined by that stunning star of the silver screen, Brian Baker, the gentleman from Georgia. And this segment, Brian, you had shot me over topics. We were brainstorming ideas ahead of the show. And one of them that you mentioned was how presidential elections have changed over the last 30 years. And I thought that really merited some consideration because, wow, there's a big difference between how things go down now compared to how they were in 1994. I was but a lad of two in 94. The first presidential election I could participate in wouldn't come until 2012 when I voted for Mitt Romney. I've actually never won for a, or never voted for a president who won election. I voted for Mitt Romney in 2012, Gary Johnson in 2016, and President Trump in 2020, and I've none of my candidates made it to office. I'm bad at picking winners.
Thank you for that little drop about your age the day after I turned 46. I greatly appreciate that, Ethan.
No problem, Brian. That's what I'm here for.
No, good. God bless you, man. No, you know, I find, you know, YouTube, as horrible as it is, and as much garbage as it contains that we have to protect our children from, it can also be highly educational and informative. And I find past political debates to be wildly educational and true eye openers as we look at the past and truly examine, because as time goes by, people forget, you know, your perception of what things were and the things that people believed, it gets twisted. And so you go back and you look at these debates and you see how both of the political parties have wildly shifted in their platforms. But more importantly, you see how we have had a complete and total breakdown in decorum in the world of politics. And one of my favorite debates to go back and watch, I like to go back and watch the debates between Clinton, Bush, and Perot. And the thing that always stands out to me is that they do engage each other like gentlemen, but more importantly, the problems that they're trying to solve, the issues that have them concerned, they're the exact same challenges that we're trying to tackle today. And it's the same thing that every politician comes along and promises they're going to fix for the sake of our children, and it never gets done. The problem just gets worse and worse and worse. Debt, the national debt being one of the main focuses of the presidential election between Bush, Bill Clinton, and Ross Perot. And there's this great segment, there's this great portion where Ross Perot is talking about our national debt and how it's a major threat to the future of our country. You know what the debt was back then, Ethan? A little over $4 trillion.
Pocket change.
Yeah.
Well, actually, in 30 years, that's the big difference between now and 30 years ago. We have risen the debt more than $30 trillion, a trillion every year on average. That's pathetic.
But it's also gut-wrenching in that you go back and you look at that and you think, man, I mean, Ross Perot, what I had remembered in my mind of Ross Perot was primarily the Dana Carvey character on SNL. When you go back and you watch those debates or you watch the infomercials that Ross Perot gave, man, he saw it all. He saw it all coming. Everything that he predicted, it played out just as he said it would. And it's depressing because you realize, gosh, if we'd have just turned the corner back then, taken our medicine, we would be in an entirely different situation today as a country.
Although the problems have remained the same, the politicians are staggeringly different. And 30 years ago, Bill Clinton, famous liberal Bill Clinton, Democrat President Bill Clinton, sounded like Donald Trump does today. This is a clip you shared with me from a 1995 State of the Union from Clinton.
All Americans, not only in the states most heavily affected, but in every place in this country, are rightly disturbed by the large numbers of illegal aliens entering our country. The jobs they hold might otherwise be held by citizens or legal immigrants. The public service they use impose burdens on our taxpayers. That's why our administration has moved aggressively to secure our borders more, by hiring a record number of new border guards, by deporting twice as many criminal aliens as ever before, by cracking down on illegal hiring, by barring welfare benefits to illegal aliens. In the budget I will present to you, we will try to do more to speed the deportation of illegal aliens who are arrested for crimes, to better identify illegal aliens in the workplace, as recommended by the commission headed by former Congresswoman Barbara Jordan. We are a nation of immigrants, but we are also a nation of laws. It is wrong and ultimately self-defeating for a nation of immigrants to permit the kind of abuse of our immigration laws we have seen in recent years, and we must do more to stop it.
You and I are not so different.
How refreshing is it to hear a triangulation era Bill Clinton sounding like a so-called far-right extremist of today?
Yeah, I was going to say, yeah, he was a much more moderate president than people actually remember. I don't know what happened to him in the years since he left office, but you go back and look at some of the things that he did, and, you know, I mean, reforming the welfare system, he did a good job of walking the middle line. Unfortunately,
well, he had to retain office.
Yeah, but he, you know what? I mean, it's just fascinating to me because Democrats were all about it, behind him 100%.
Yeah.
And now, I mean, that's just it's just sacrilege for a Democrat to speak with that kind of sense. Not acceptable.
Well, by today's standard, he would be utterly crucified for making illegal immigration a major aspect of his presidency, if something that he's addressing in the State of the Union. Hell, they lost their minds because Joe Biden accurately referred to the murderer of Lake and Riley as an illegal, and the mainstream media flipped their lids.
The president is walking back a controversial term he used during his State of the Union remarks. Biden used the word, quote, illegal.
He used the term illegal. He used the word illegal.
He used the word illegal.
He used the word illegals to describe people.
He did use a word that did bother people. Immigration advocates don't want to hear him use the word illegal.
I kind of jumped as well when I heard that word.
We normally don't use that word because people are not illegal.
To be clear, no human being is illegal.
Congressman Chuy Garcia saying he was extremely disappointed to hear the president use that word illegal.
Joaquin Castro has said, like, this using that word and illegal dehumanizing is problematic. What did you make of that?
That's probably true. He probably should have used a different word.
Like Joe Biden's ad-libs in the past, this one kind of got him in some trouble, particularly with Democrats who don't use the word illegal, we call undocumented workers.
Saying to the broad Democratic base, you know, I hear you, I hear your concern, and I shouldn't use that word is a smart thing to do.
We've reached a final conclusion on item 9. Illegal!
They lost their minds. Just for, I mean, you know, hell, we just heard the clip of Bill Clinton talking about illegal immigration 30 years ago. And in that time, the left has moved so far down in the depths of communism and socialism. They're practically a different party than they were 30 years ago. I mean, it's stuff like that that makes you yearn for the days of Bill Clinton, as far-fetched as that may seem.
Clutching their pearls over the use of the word illegal, too. I mean, it's just it's such
crap,
a convenient
man.
Distraction from the critical issue at hand. How many, you know, I would wager that the majority of individuals coming across the border probably are not too worried about what the president, what term he uses to describe them. I don't think anyone that has, risked their life and paid drug cartels and managed to get across the border is really sweating the use of the word illegal all that much or is worried about labels.
Well, and you also have a sinister set of illegal migrants who are seeking to exploit the system because of how porous the border is and to the detriment of the American citizenry. Now you have Mexican TikTokers who are instructing their followers how to obtain homes by squatting in them, because now some liberal states recognize so-called squatters' rights to abscond with your property. You have Venezuelan drug cartel members, one of whom was just recently captured, again, exploiting the southern border with sinister intent to commit more crimes here in the United States. All of this allowed by the disastrous Biden immigration administration policy.
Yes, and make no mistake, America, now every single state is a border state.
Yep.
It's not just Texas, all right? You know, we are all dealing with the problem because they ship them into our area. And man, I'm telling you, I pray for our country that we have a moment of enlightenment and sanity. But I'm not sure we're ever going to get there, Ethan, no matter who's sitting in the White House.
Thanks for listening to 93 WIABC. You're right. I'm not sure that we will have a return to sanity, but certainly in 2024, this is a time for choosing. And although both candidates incredibly flawed, they do offer very radically different visions for America. And we'll talk a little bit more about that coming up next, where Donald Trump made a campaign stop over the weekend in Dayton, Ohio. And oh boy, people really lost their minds about one of the things he said regarding the American economy. We'll tell you more about that coming up next. Stay tuned.
Hammer and Nigel.
Joe Biden speaks gibberish. Joe Biden has a hard time walking. He can't find his way off of a stage. Don't give me this crap that Joe Biden's cognitively all there and way superior to Donald Trump in that category. This stapler that we've got in the studio is completely more qualified to be running this country right now than Joe Biden.
Hammer and Nigel, weekdays 3 till 7 on 93 WIPC and WIPC.com.
Want to explore using Mitsubishi Electric ductless mini splits to heat and cool your home or business? Learn more at absolutecomfort.org. That's absolutecomfort.org.
I'm still going for it, even with higher stroke risk from atrial fibrillation and a regular heartbeat not caused by a heart valve problem. Over a 3-year study, Eliquis apixaban tablets reduced stroke risk better than warfarin, and over 97% of Eliquis patients did not experience a stroke. A first stroke occurred in 2.9% of warfarin patients versus 2.3% of Eliquis patients.
Don't stop taking prescription Eliquis without asking your doctor. It may increase your stroke risk. Eliquis can cause serious and, in rare cases, fatal bleeding. Don't take Eliquis if you have an artificial heart valve, abnormal bleeding, or antiphospholipid syndrome. While taking, you may bruise more easily or take longer for bleeding to stop. A spinal injection while on Eliquis increases risk of blood clots, which may cause paralysis, the inability to move. Get medical help right away for unexpected bleeding, unusual bruising, or tingling, numbness, or muscle weakness. Medications such as aspirin products, NSAIDs, SSRIs, SNRIs, and blood thinners may increase bleeding risk. Tell your doctor about all planned medical or dental procedures. Learn more at Eliquis.com or call 1-855-ELIQUIS.
Will you spend another summer working on your yard for your spouse, kids, and guests? Or would you rather spend the summer with your spouse, playing with the kids, and relaxing with guests? Hire Blue Duck Lawn Care to get the super healthy lawn you'll love and neighbors will envy. Blue Duck does the fertilizing and weed control. You just mow to get a lush, thick lawn. Best in your neighborhood. If it's got to be green, hire Blue. BlueDuckLawnCare.com. Remember, if it's got to be green, hire Blue. BlueDuckLawnCare.com.
Did you know one of the best investments you can make? It's in yourself. At My Computer Career, in just a few months, you could start your new career in the high-demand, recession-resistant field of information technology. Isn't it time you invest in you and start a career in networking, cybersecurity, AI, or upskill to boost your current IT career? So, get the ROI you deserve at My Computer Career. No experience necessary. Start now at MyComputerCareer.edu.
Financial aid is available for qualified students, including the GI Bill.
Indy's biggest party is back. Miller Lite Carb Day, Friday, May 24, featuring George Thorogood and the Destroyers. With special guest, Gin Blossoms. Miller Lite Carb Day, May 24th at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. Concert, pit, and VIP tickets on sale now at IMS.com.
It's the Kendall and Casey Show.
Because I invested in family farms led by my Secretary of Agriculture, who knows more about this than anybody I know. We're better able to stay in the family for those farms and their children and grandchildren won't have to leave.
Well, that's what we tell ourselves, isn't it, Boomhauer?
Oh, yes, wait a minute, Mr. Boseman.
That's so perfect. How long did that take you to make, Kevin? That's great.
I probably spent maybe 45 minutes on it.
That's all? That sounds like it could take you more than 45 minutes.
Okay, it's probably more like an hour.
Yeah. No, I mean, you can tell that there's a lot of production element work that goes into sound bites like that. And it's just 30 seconds. Like, no, it could take hours to get the balancing right and get the right clips.
Yeah.
I understand. So I appreciate production elements like that.
I get pretty lost in that when I make those. It's pretty fun.
Thanks for listening.
Well done.
Thanks for listening to the Kendall and Casey Show. I'm Ethan Hatcher. That's Brian Baker. And of course, producer Kevin McNamara on the board, pressing the buttons and doing the things to make the show function. Last segment, we were talking about how the presidential elections have evolved over the last years and how the visions that are offered by the candidates in some cases are very, very different, even though the same problems are being echoed. You heard the 1995 State of the Union address by Bill Clinton talking about the urgent problem addressing illegal immigration. And now we have Donald Trump echoing the same messages. This was while he was at a campaign stop in Dayton, Ohio, over the weekend, making the right prescriptions for America.
Not one more American life should be lost to migrant crime. When I'm president of the United States, we will demand justice for Laken. On day one, my administration will terminate every open border policy of the Biden administration. We begin the largest domestic deportation operation in American history.
Oh, yes! 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 Oh, yes! 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 Yes!
That sounds fantastic! I know they're going to excoriate him in the mainstream media, but we need the mass deportations. We've got an incredible criminal illegal alien problem going on right now with dozens of American citizens that have been killed through murder or through negligence or through drunken driving accidents. Like, this is a problem. So it's good. Yes, I support the message, Donald Trump. Good job. But do you really believe it, though, when he says it? And it's a good line, but do you buy it?
Well, I think the problem is whether he means it or not, the damage has already been done. I mean, at this point, I think, you know, the patient is bleeding out. All you can do is slow the bleeding, you know, perhaps stop the bleeding. But, you know, we've already the issue, the problem is already here, man. And I don't know how you undo what's been done by the Biden administration. But the other thing that I always come back to is that we've become so polarized over the course of the last several presidential elections. And I remember thinking when Donald Trump was elected the first time, this is great, but there's going to be a balance to it.
Yeah.
You know, we're going to pay for it down the road. And I wonder the same thing. You know, if he is reelected, it's going to be wonderful for our country. But I know there's going to be that balance and that whiplash on the other side of it once again.
Well, he actually needs to make good on some of the policy proposals, things like building the wall. He didn't even get that halfway through. There were lots of opportunities to pass immigration reform and laws through the Congress that were missed by the Trump administration. Instead, relying on executive orders that were immediately undone by Joe Biden as soon as he took office. And this was a criticism offered by a fellow Republican, Chip Roy, in Congress last week.
Another member of Congress resigned today. So now I'll be told, Chip, we only have a one-seat majority or two-seat majority. I don't even know what it is anymore. Let me ask you a question. Does it matter? In 2018, we had the House, we had the Senate, we had the White House, and we had a bigger majority than we have today, and we utterly failed to secure the border. Totally dropped the ball. Didn't do it.
He's out of line, but he's right.
We had the opportunity. We had all three houses, all three branches. You know, we had all two houses and then the executive office, I should say. We had the White House, the Senate, the House of Representatives, and they all could have worked together to pass immigration reform, and it didn't happen. And that's why I question, like, although as nice as it sounds and as much as I agree, does Donald Trump mean what he says?
No, you know, and the promise for immigration reform has been going on for, like, we spoke about before, 30 plus years, man, and it never gets fixed. It only gets worse.
Now, here was something else that Donald Trump was speaking about during that campaign stop in Dayton, Ohio, and he was addressing the American economy. But somehow, Brian, the liberal media has completely taken this out of context and are now saying that he would attack America if he loses the next election, promising a bloodbath, except that's not at all what he said. And here's the clip in context that the media doesn't want you to hear.
You know, Mexico has taken over a period of 30 years, 34% of the automobile manufacturing business in our country. Think of it, went to Mexico. China now is building a couple of massive plants where they're going to build the cars in Mexico and think that they're going to sell those cars into the United States with no tax at the border. Let me tell you something to China. If you're listening, President Xi, and you and I are friends, but he understands the way I deal, those big monster car manufacturing plants that you're building in Mexico right now, and you think you're going to get that, you're going to not hire Americans, and you're going to sell the cars to us now, we're going to put a 100% tariff on every single car that comes across the line, and you're not going to be able to sell those cars. If I get elected, now if I don't get elected, it's going to be a bloodbath for the whole, that's going to be the least of it. It's going to be a bloodbath for the country. That'll be the least of it. But they're not going to sell those cars. They're building massive factories. A friend of mine, all he does is build car manufacturing plants. He's the biggest in the world.
So clearly, Trump talking about the economy there, but they've somehow twisted that into promising a second American Civil War. What is this, Brian? Like, this is something that constantly baffled me during the Trump administration. There's many legitimate criticisms that one can offer and unwise statements that Trump has made. Just let the man talk. Why do you have to make crap up about him? The liberal media loses so much credibility when they pull crap like this. It makes me daffy.
Yeah, although I do have to say, Donald Trump, he's been in the game long enough now that, I wish he would be a little bit more careful with choosing the words that he uses, because he knows that they're going to be turned around and used as a weapon against him and distract from the message and the mission, man.
Sure, but I'm not even sure I would have seen that one coming, and we've heard montage clips of the media using the same term, bloodbath, over and over again over the last several decades. It's not like, and he was talking about the automotive industry. They just had to shave down, what was it, that 3 or 4 second clip and isolate it to make him look bad. But that's not at all what the context talked about. And it's really shameless what the media is doing here. And of course, you have campaign flunkies like Joe Biden who are talking about, this just shows Joe Biden's campaign spokesman, Quentin Folks, I should say, who are talking about, it just shows the character of Donald Trump at his core.
Trump's team claims that Trump's use of the word bloodbath was taken out of context, was he?
No. This is exactly who Donald Trump is. We saw him call on his supporters to storm the Capitol 4 years ago, and he's doubling down promoting violence this time around. And this is just right out of the playbook. Trump is weak and deeply insecure about this election, and he's only in it for himself. Our campaign has been saying this for months, and Trump is saying the quiet part out loud. And the people who are saying that his comments were taken out of context haven't said anything about all the other things that Trump has done, all the other times that he's incited political violence. And so, no, it wasn't taken out of context at all. This is who Donald Trump is, and America needs to stand up and listen to him.
Wow, the land of make-believe.
It's utterly shameless what's going on, Brian. I have no other way to put it.
You know, I used to believe that the commentators and the folks on the left that would latch onto stuff like this and push this narrative, that they were fully aware of what they were doing and didn't actually believe any of this crap that Donald Trump's actually calling for a bloodbath if he doesn't win the elections, trying to scare people from going to voting booths. But I've come to learn, Ethan, they do believe it with their entire core. They're lost in this fantasy narrative, just like you referenced, man. And they truly are terrified to their core. They've gone that far off the path, man.
Well, I mean, you would have to be deluded to think that this would pass muster with the American people and pass the smell test. It was pointed out on Joe Rogan's show that media is being incredibly dishonest and disingenuous here. And it's hard to believe that they wouldn't understand that they would be caught, because all of this is on tape. But as you say, they are so self-deluded, they have convinced themselves that it is true.
I mean, I'm sure you're aware of this recent Donald Trump speech where he talked about a bloodbath.
Oh, God, yeah.
What the actual phrase was. See if you can find that, Jamie, because it's actually important to highlight how not just inaccurate, but it's just deceptive the media was in their depiction of what he said, and that they are taking this quote out of context and trying to say that there's going to be a civil war if he doesn't get elected, which is not what he was talking about at all. Because it's so disturbing that they would, first of all, that they would think that they could get away with it in this day and age with all the scrutiny and all the with social media and all the independent journalists that exist now, which is one of the more interesting things about the demise of corporate media, the demise in trust. Trust in corporate media is at an all-time low, and so this has led to a rise in true independent journalists.
What? You don't say. You don't say. You don't say.
And the more Democrats lean into and cater into these deceptions and delusions, the more sure they make it for Donald Trump to obtain victory in the 2024 cycle. Thanks for listening to 93 WIBC, Kendall and Casey Show. Ethan and Brian filling in. Coming up next, we're going to tell you about an unbelievable interaction in Queens between a poor woman attempting to evict squatters and the police officers who came to prevent that. We'll tell you more in the next segment. Stay tuned.
93 WIBC Mobile News. On the level. On the go.
They'll go away. I'm Kirk Darling. Here's what's trending at 11:30. Student loans for thousands of people are going to be wiped clean soon.
If you are a teacher, a firefighter, a nurse, or another kind of public service worker, you might have an email in your inbox from President Biden this morning because the administration's canceling student loans for another 78,000 people through their public service loan forgiveness program. They're also emailing an additional 380,000 borrowers to tell them that they were within 2 years of getting their debt canceled.
Fox's Jackie Heinrich. The U.S. has submitted a draft resolution to the U.N. calling for an immediate ceasefire in Gaza that's tied to the release of hostages held by Hamas. That's what Secretary of State Antony Blinken said Wednesday as he meets with leaders in the Middle East. I'm Kirk Darling, on the level, on the go, and on WIBC.com.
Go where the pros go. Drexel Interiors for Timberlake Kitchen and Bath Cabinets. Visit Drexel's new design center on 146th Street at River Road or on North Shadeland. DrexelIN.com.
The IRS is the most powerful collection agency on earth, and if you owe back taxes, the news isn't good. The IRS is raising the interest rate it charges on unpaid taxes, and further rate hikes are expected. Most people don't know it, but the IRS adds interest charges to your tax debts daily. So if you owe the IRS today, you'll owe even more tomorrow. And it doesn't stop until you get right with the IRS. The good news is getting right can start with one phone call to Optima Tax Relief, America's number one tax relief firm. Optima's tax professionals specialize in the Fresh Start Initiative, a powerful IRS program that can save you thousands if you qualify. In fact, the experts at Optima have resolved over $1 billion in tax debt for their clients. Call now for a free consultation.
Call 800-357-6499. 800-357-6499. 800-357-6499.
Optima Tax Relief.
Some restrictions apply. For complete details, please visit OptimaTaxRelief.com.
Hey, Mark Dietl is the only real estate expert I trust and recommend with the sale of my home. Maybe you're worried about settling for less money with a lowball instant offer, or maybe you want to get rid of your investment property, kind of like Greg in Franklin. Greg's tenant moved out of his investment property, and he was done with it, ready to sell. Heard about Mark Dietl on the radio. In 15 days on the market, Greg had a cash offer, and it was done. Selling with Mark Dietl was fast and profitable.
What separates Mark Dietl from the competition is the guarantee. Mark Dietl guarantees your home sold at a mutually agreed-upon price and deadline, or he will buy it. You pick the move date, no long-term contracts, no required repairs, and you can cancel at any time. Reach out to Mark Dietl today, 317-755-4232, or go to markdietl.com. Mark D-I-E-T-E-L, markdietl.com. Tell him Hammer and Nigel sent you.
Get ready for storm season because you know as well as I do, storms in Indiana can be fierce and they can come out of nowhere. So don't wait for a leak to have your roof inspected. Have peace of mind about your roof being able to handle any storm. Moss Roofing, M-O-S-S, mossroofing.com provides free inspections and can spot potential issues before they turn into costly repairs. Whether you're looking for a siding replacement after a strong wind or a roof replacement after a hailstorm, Moss Roofing has options that fit any budget. Just ask Moss Roofing about their payment plans. No matter your situation, Moss Roofing has you covered with a job done right every single time. I love that. That's very funny. Contact Moss Roofing today, 317-747-3665. 317-747-3665. Tell them Tony Katz sent you. Moss Roofing, 747-3665, or online at Moss, M-O-S-S, mossroofing.com.
Having health insurance is important. So, if you or anyone in your family has Medicaid or CHIP, listen up. Check your mail for a renewal form from your state. Complete the form and mail it back right away so you don't lose your coverage. If you do lose Medicaid or CHIP, visit healthcare.gov to see if you're eligible to enroll in a low-cost, quality health plan. Keep your family covered. Paid for by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services.
Indy's leader in patio installation is now offering a new driveway package. Schedule a free estimate today at IndyDecorativeConcrete.com. That's IndyDecorativeConcrete.com.
You're listening to the Kendall and Casey Show on 93 WIPC.
Well, everybody's heard about the bird.
Love Serpent Bird. Thanks for listening to the Kendall and Casey Show. I'm Ethan Hatcher. That's producer Kev on the board. And we're joined by the esteemed Brian Baker, gentleman from Georgia. Been having a hell of a show, Brian. I've had a lot of fun with today's broadcast.
Yeah, me too, man. It's, you know, I feel a little rusty, but it's great to be back home at WIBC.
Yeah, always happy to do a broadcast with you, man. Brighten up the airwaves. Although, thank we're about buddy. To darken them with some really bad news coming out of New York. Earlier in the show, you and I were discussing about how now, in some cases, police departments are being left completely unstaffed during the overnight hours, like the Sheriff's Department in Washington County here in Indiana, or Pittsburgh police departments in Pennsylvania being left unstaffed for hours. So now they're endangering American citizens. But to the extent that you're being left to your own devices in times of crisis, you're also being assaulted by police officers who are enforcing terrible laws passed by liberal states designed to deprive you of your property rights. This coming out of Queens in New York City, where a woman inherited a home following the passing of her parents. And soon after it was vacated, somebody moved in and began squatting. And now she is unable to remove the illegal trespassers from her own property due to New York state laws. And all of this was caught on camera while a local news station was making their report.
A squatter standoff. A property owner confronts a group of people she says moved into her $1 million home in Queens. And our cameras were rolling as dozens of officers showed up.
Several people were taken away in handcuffs, and one of those arrested may surprise you.
Investigative reporter Dan Krauth joins us now with more on what happened. Tell us, Dan.
Well, this is a very big growing problem. I received dozens of tips from viewers about this in just the past week. I went to do what I thought was going to be a routine interview. Instead, we capture what police and property owners are dealing with on a daily basis.
I have video of you early on.
To understand how this day ended,
we need the police right away.
With multiple 911 calls and arrests, we have to start at the beginning.
Adele, the hardest question is, how do you say your name?
We met Adele Andaloro outside the home her parents left her in Flushing, Queens. She's in the process of selling it.
No, he left it.
But she's been locked out. She claims squatters moved in on February 6th and refused to leave.
What's it like being here knowing you can't go inside of your own home?
It's enraging. It really is.
This is happening all over the country. It's not just in New York, Brian, but also I've seen several stories coming out of Georgia, where now property owners are being deprived of their own homes through these ridiculous so-called squatters' rights laws. And if you ask me, squatters' rights is a contradiction in terms. It's an oxymoron. It's something that can't and shouldn't be allowed to operate in a civilized society.
What was the root of this law when it was originally created? Obviously, now it's being exploited to the extreme, but there must have been some kind of rationale at the beginning where they thought this was going to be a good thing before they passed it.
It starts where all of these disastrous laws begin, with the feelings, Brian. There are people who need housing, and you're depriving them of their ability to live in houses that they didn't pay for.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah. Well, I mean, and now they're empowering the law to be utilized against the citizenry. So this woman had her house deprived from her. She shows up. The squatter had actually left the door unlocked, so she lawfully entered into her own home that she owns, that she has a legal registered deed for, that she pays taxes on, that she pays utilities on, and the police escorted her away in handcuffs, empowering this obnoxious buffoon who's taken over her house to hold it hostage, potentially for years.
In New York, squatters have rights after 30 days.
By the time that someone does their investigation and they do their work and their job, we'll be well over the 30 days, and this man will have stolen my home. And now she's back.
Why are you here?
She unlocked the front door, saw our cameras, and took off.
It's open. Let's go in the house. It's open.
Adele and her daughter, with the property deed in hand, went inside.
This is my furniture. These are my curtains.
She didn't just find her belongings inside.
There's a man sleeping right there. Get out of my house.
She found two men.
How long have you lived here?
I moved in about 2 days ago.
They've called the police on me, and I've called the locksmiths. I didn't come in illegally. The door was open.
Police started interviewing neighbors and looking for documents.
Do you have something that shows that you've been here for 30 days?
They took the man who told me he had been renting for 2 days out in handcuffs.
They got one out.
And escorted the other guy off the property.
Now you're afraid to come out.
I'm not coming out. You broke through the front door.
Officer.
The man called the police on her.
So why is it that I have to leave and he doesn't have to leave?
Because technically he can't be kicked out. You need to go to court.
They consider this a landlord-tenant issue. And by law, it has to be handled through the housing court, not with police.
If you own this house, you would not want her inside.
I don't own the house. I don't own this house.
Exactly,
yes.
She does.
Yes, but then once again, you should know how the law works.
I do know how it works.
There's rules to the... As you gotta go to court and send me to civil court.
The police department doesn't have the lease?
No.
He's got no documentation.
Just bills.
So Adele, you're getting arrested right now?
I'm being arrested.
For what?
For being in my own home.
And where's your lease?
She's fighting the house. It's not her house anymore.
My deed is current and legal.
Arrested for unlawful eviction. She changed the locks on a man who claims he lives there.
So how does this all end then? When do you leave?
The way it ends is either she pays me my money that I put into the house, pay me the money, and I'll leave, or send me to court, and we deal with the judge in court. It's that simple.
It's not that simple. It's a long process. Evictions can take close to 2 years to complete.
I don't want to live on this planet anymore.
Literally holding the house hostage, Brian.
I don't understand that. These squatters' rights, they kick in after 30 days, right?
Yeah, well, in New York they do. It's different, you know, according to different jurisdictions, but yeah. And then it can take you more than 2 years to evict the squatter from unlawfully residing in your residence.
So prior to that, the police can throw them out on what? Breaking and entering? And if that's the case, does breaking and entering cease to become a crime that you can be prosecuted for after a 30-day window has passed? I mean, is that the way that we're moving here?
You can make a crime apparently
and there's a clock?
I mean, they're not even required to provide documentation. As you heard in the news report, they didn't have a valid lease because, of course, they didn't. They didn't have any verification or hint of proof to substantiate their residency in the house. And yet the actual homeowner who brought the deed as recognized by New York with her, and she was escorted away in handcuffs. This is sad, Brian. This is deeply sad and emblematic of the systemic problems that are facing America right now. When you're being left to your own devices and abandoned during the overnight hours in police departments from thievery, from breaking and entering, from assault, from domestic abuse, and then the police department is being weaponized against you to protect squatters' rights, this force does no longer serve the citizenry.
Cannot believe it. Ethan, you see what you've done here? I started out today in a good mood, happy, joyful, looking forward to the future, and you've scared the crap out of me for the last 3 hours.
Oh,
thanks a lot.
I'm good at that. And if for the last segment, we're going to be talking about your birthday blues, reflecting on 46 years here on Earth?
Oh, good. Yeah, although my mother called and she said, I can't believe it's been 45 years since you were born. I had to correct her and say, well, Ma, it's been a little longer than that.
It's been 46. So not only do we have the police who are being weaponized against the citizenry, but now we're also being endangered because, naturally, of Joe Biden's porous border laws. And it's not just people who are seeking asylum and wanting a better life. It is criminals who are exploiting the system for their own benefit and attacking American citizens. In some cases, exploiting the same squatters' rights loopholes to deprive deprive citizens of their properties, and they're being instructed about this on social media, or just using the porous border as an opportunity to commit rape, mayhem, drug dealing, and pandemonium, such as this cartel member from Venezuela who was detained here in America after illegally crossing the border.
29-year-old Venezuelan Arabe Segundo Pereira was arrested in New Braunfels. In a press conference, several high-ranking Colombian officials speaking about Pereira's arrest, calling the Venezuelan native an alleged second-in-command for the gang Satanias dangerous. We obtained arrest warrants laying out Pereira's history. Homeland Security investigation saying he was wanted for homicide, drug trafficking, and extortion in Colombia. One of his alleged victims, a 7-year-old boy.
They start with petty crime.
Retired Homeland Security agent Adi Jimenez spoke with us earlier this year about gang members in the United States.
The behavior that we've seen is behavior of people that do not come into the country for the purpose of migration, asylum seekers. It's strictly for exploiting the criminal enterprise.
He said it. There it is.
As if this wasn't already incredibly transparent and simple common sense to the majority of Americans. But that lets you know exactly how malicious these politicians are in inflicting their partisan goals, regardless of the carnage that it leaves in their wake.
Yeah, they do not care. They do not care, man.
Country is collapsing, man. Happy birthday.
Thanks so much for lifting my spirits. God bless you.
You're listening to 93 WIBC. Up next, Brian's going to tell us a little bit more about some really cool movie memorabilia I saw you posting on the Twitter machine. You got a giant record, and I need to know what kind of record player you play something like that on. We'll hear more about it coming up next on the Kendall and Casey Show. Stay tuned.
Coming up on the Hammer and Nigel Show, March Madness is here. Plus, even though Rob Kendall is gambling at the casinos, he's agreed to go off the rails. We'll see if he can stay slightly sober for that segment. That's coming up at 3 o'clock right after the news, 93 WIBC.
I have diabetes. I'm at risk for pneumococcal pneumonia.
I have asthma. I'm at risk, too.
If you're 19 or older with chronic conditions like asthma, diabetes, COPD, or heart disease, or are 65 or older, you are at increased risk for pneumococcal pneumonia. Ask your doctor or pharmacist about Prevnar 20, pneumococcal 20-valent conjugate vaccine, a Pfizer vaccine that can help protect you against pneumococcal pneumonia in just one dose. Even if you've already been vaccinated with other pneumonia vaccines, Prevnar 20 may help provide added protection. Prevnar 20 is approved for adults to help prevent infections from 20 strains of the bacteria that cause pneumococcal pneumonia. Continued approval may depend on a supportive study. Don't get Prevnar 20 if you've had a severe allergic reaction to the vaccine or its ingredients. Adults with weakened immune systems may have a lower response to the vaccine. Side effects include pain and swelling at the injection site, fatigue, headache, muscle, and joint pain. For full prescribing information, please call 1-855-213-2138 or visit Prevnar20.com.
Jefferson Shreve stepped up to fight when no one else would. He put it all on the line, and the liberals smeared him for it with ads like this.
Donald Trump and Jefferson Shreve. He's an original supporter of Donald Trump.
They attacked Shreve for being a conservative.
Jefferson Shreve, an A rating from the NRA.
Attacked him for being a loyal Republican.
Look who was there. Jefferson Shreve. He was proud to be on the Trump campaign and proud of his own A rating from the NRA.
All because Shreve would get tough, back the blue, and stop the crime. But we don't have to accept their lawlessness at our border, in our suburbs, in our state. Because Jefferson Shreve is running for Congress, and he's a fighter for law, order, and a secure border. Jefferson Shreve for Congress.
I'm Jefferson Shreve, and I approve this message.
Paid for by Shreve for Congress.
But take your time, think a lot. I think of everything you've got, for you will still be here tomorrow, but your dreams may not.
Oh, is this a conspiracy? You guys are just trying to push me off the cliff at this point.
I'm glad you appreciate that specially selected bump, Brian. I chose it just for you.
Yeah, God bless you.
Happy
both.
Birthday, sir.
Uh-huh. Yo, I will have
you
to
said
say
you
this.
Had the birthday blues. I picked something on theme.
Thanks so much. You truly care, Ethan. You know what? Actually, it was an okay birthday. It started out as a very gloomy day where I didn't even want to get out of bed, but I'm like that on most birthdays. The day goes on, you know, you get out in the sunshine and you start hearing from people that, you know, wish you a happy birthday, and you get reminded of how many great friends you have and the people that you're surrounded by that really mean something to you and enrich your life. And so, you know, by the end of the day, I was feeling pretty good.
Good.
And then I crashed again before I went to sleep.
Well, how can you crash when you obtained what seems like a really cool piece of movie memorabilia? Now, I didn't recognize the screen cap of the movie that it was utilized in, but you've got this rather large record display that can be hung on a wall. And what is this record of? What movie was it used in? Why is this meaningful for you?
Well, see, and that's just it, Ethan. I have this thing. I've never been much on autograph collecting, but sure, I really have a thing for movie props, but movie props from films that are meaningful to me, and generally very obscure movie props where you kind of have to know, you got to know in order to really get it and recognize what it is. And so my wife and I kind of have this thing where we've decorated our house and it's covered with various Easter eggs for film fans. Like we have a 237 on our guest room door. And I have my very first prop that I got was this a little bird that was utilized in the movie The Birds, Alfred Hitchcock. Some guy gave to me because his father was a firefighter at Universal back when they made that film, and they'd thrown all these birds in the dumpster, and apparently his dad rescued them. And I went over to this guy's place because I was going to rent a room from him. They had them sitting on little wires all around the outside of the house. He gave me one for luck. I thought, well, that's kind of cool.
Yeah, that's
so this latest acquisition, man, I'm very excited about, because there was a movie in the early 80s called Eddie and the Cruisers. And man, I'm telling you, that was a movie that came out and it bombed. And then all of a sudden it was right in the infancy of HBO. And so HBO picked it up and started showing it several times per week. And I was right at that age, and we actually had HBO, and I just watched that movie over and over again, fell in love with it, just had a very profound impact on me. And so there is a scene, the character Eddie Wilson, he's this rock star who was, he was on the way to genius and ultimate fame, and then he dies prematurely. And I don't know, it was kind of based a little bit on the conspiracy theories about Elvis faking his death or Jim Morrison. So anyhow, there's this scene where they're in a recording studio at Satin Records, and there is this giant sign that says Satin Records that looks like an enormous LP.
Yeah.
All right. It's just this big giant record. And so for years, I have wanted that prop, and I have been desperately trying to track it down. And I finally came to the conclusion it was probably destroyed after production, so I'm just going to have it made. And I'll be dog, I was able to reach out to my neighbor, and for a substantial amount of money, I was able to have that prop recreated. It is 47 inches in diameter. It's huge. And my wife has agreed to let me place it in a very prominent place in our house. So finally, mission accomplished. That was a prop that was a good 35, 40 years in the making, and I have it.
Congratulations, sir. It looks amazing. I mean, I saw the picture you uploaded to Twitter. Actually, the record itself reminds me of old antique Columbia Records advertising. They have a very similar scheme where it was just a giant disc with the Columbia logo at the center. So maybe that's what they were inspired by originally during creation of the movie prop.
Yes, and I will tell you, Ethan, you have no idea how difficult it can be to transport a 47-inch diameter giant sign from the place that produced it back to your home.
Ooh,
wouldn't
yeah.
even fit my truck completely. I kind of had to put it up on its side, you know, like folks that go to Lowe's and they underestimate just how much vehicle they need in order to get their supplies back to the house.
Could you put it on top? Could you put it on like on top of the station wagon and strap it down, maybe?
Like
just lay it flat, just, yeah.
Yes, strap it down up there. No, it made it home safely. And my daughter is just giddy with excitement, which is pretty cool because she's 7 years old, but she is all into that movie just like I was at her age. So
that's
very
great.
Cool, man.
That's great that, yeah. that you're getting to share moments like that with your daughter. That, I mean, I think that's what makes having kids really special, you know, seeing a little bit of yourself inside of them as they grow up in age.
Yeah. Yeah. It's it is wonderful and joyous and terrifying all at the same time when you look at the world that they're growing up in, which is very different from the world we grew up in, Ethan.
True, but I mean, you can take a little bit of solace and a silver lining for having moments like that with your daughter. And when things seem grim and the skies are dark and you feel the blues because you're getting a year older, you have them as a legacy that will live on and carry your memory after you. That's nice.
Yes, indeed. Yeah. Yeah, except for the people that can't stand me, in which case, you know, I'm gonna make sure that Sarah has kids. I'm just gonna keep passing those genes down, baby.
Right. In that case, you live despite them. Uh-huh. Now, see, I didn't have as much relation to birthdays because, like we talked about in an earlier segment, I was raised as Jehovah's Witness, and I just didn't celebrate birthdays. And now that I'm allowed to celebrate birthdays, it's kind of hard to get energized about it when it's not something you've spent the majority of your life doing. You know, and certainly as an adult, you already kind of retire the birthdays anyway.
Yeah, yeah. They're just not as exciting when you get past the age of about 30.
Oh, well, I'm there already. I'll be turning 32 in November. So I'm catching up with you, Brian.
Reminding me how much younger you are. Do you have to do that?
I am catching up with you. This has been an amazing show, guys. I've really enjoyed that. Thank you, Kev, for the fantastic production work. I loved your bump selection. That was good stuff, as always.
Thank you.
And Brian, I love working with you. Anytime we're on WIBC, I have a good time. And I hope the listeners
do
too.
Yeah, I do too, Ethan. I do too. It's really enjoyable for me. So thanks for inviting me. I had a great time and it was good to be back home on WIBC.
And hopefully we will be returning in the near future to the airwaves of WIBC. You can, of course, catch the podcast uploaded to WIBC.com on the Kendall and Casey show page. And also peep Saturday night on The Circle as well. My program that airs from 7 to 9 live every Saturday night when we're not precluded by sports get ball, that is. And that brings the broadcast to a close. Thanks for tuning in, ladies and gentlemen, to another edition of Kendall and Casey.
I have to go away. I know I have to go.
Spring is here and you want to be enjoying your life, enjoying the outdoors. It is impossible to do if you're in constant pain. Pain in your hips, your back, your shoulder, those joints, whether it's arthritis pain, sports injury, an injury on the job, talk to QC Kinetics and you don't have to live with the pain. QC Kinetics here in Indy and it's the nation's leader in regenerative medicine. We're talking about lasting joint pain relief with no surgery, no drugs, and no downtime. Pro athletes have been doing this for decades, but now this life-changing treatment is available for you. Walk, run, climb the stairs, play golf, move again with no pain, no risky surgery. It's an all-natural solution. QC Kinetics is in Eagle Creek, in Greenwood, and in Carmel. Call today, 317-559-PAIN. 317-559-PAIN. Talk to QC Kinetics. They even have Saturday appointments available. QC Kinetics. Find the location closest to you. Eagle Creek, Greenwood, and Carmel. 317-559-PAIN.
The deals and specials are sizzling hot. It's the Central Indiana Gun and Knife Show this Saturday and Sunday at the Stoutfield National Guard Armory on West Minnesota Street. The best dealers in the region, hundreds of tables, just $6 for adults, kids 12 and under free. Must be 18 or accompanied by an adult. Buy, sell, trade this Saturday, 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. and Sunday, 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. at the Stoutfield National Guard Armory. For more info, visit CentralIndianaGunShows.com.
Did you know one of the best investments you can make? It's in yourself. At My Computer Career, in just a few months, you could start your new career in the high-demand, recession-resistant field of information technology. Isn't it time you invest in you and start a career in networking, cybersecurity,